What a beautiful afternoon we have here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium in Clemson, South Carolina. It's the 2020 season opener, the Clemson Tigers taking on the Liberty Flames out of the Atlantic Sun Conference. Hi, friends, and welcome in with Tim Bray, Pete Yannity with you. Here we are, opening day. I know we're excited. And a Clemson team that looks to get back to the NCAA tourney, but has a lot of new faces in the lineup, excited as well.
A lot of new faces. The Tigers have had a great tradition. 11 years in a row, Clemson's been to the NCAA tournament. But you're right, going to have to replace guys like Logan Davidson, who was a first-round draft pick.
Scott Jackson, the Liberty coach, says, with all due respect to basketball or football, opening day in baseball is the best. I think Clemson's Monty Lee would concur. This Liberty team will certainly be a good test in the opening weekend of the season. They're the reigning Atlantic Sun champs, and they made some noise in the NCAA tourney.
Yeah, they won 43 games last year, which tied a school record. Had 7 wins over Power 5 conference teams, including South Carolina in their season opener and Tennessee in the NCAA tournament.
Yeah, so a second straight year, starting the campaign in the Palmetto State. As for Clemson, well, you look at the bats that have moved on from this program the past couple of years, and of course after last season, Logan Davidson, Grayson Bird, and some others.
Yeah, lost two players that hit 16 home runs apiece last season, so it's going to be important to see what young players are going to pick up that mantle, and as the Tigers try to hit as many home runs as they hit last year. They hit 82 last season.
So all of the guys have moved on that have, and all the new faces that are going to be a part of this program moving forward have been in place, the practices in the fall, the work in the preseason beginning in January. Let's give you the starting lineups for this first game of the campaign. Liberty with a number of hitters who return who batted better than 300 a year ago. One of them, their left fielder, Gray Betts. Brandon Rohrer in the right field, followed by the DH, Garrett Wilkinson. Wagner Locklear, an all-conference performer at shortstop. Brady Gulikowski, his first game in a Liberty uniform behind the plate. Ben Heifel, Trey McDyer, and Jalen Guy round out the lineup for the fourth-year head coach, Scott Jackson. The Tigers defensively, Henderson, Teodosio, Mikowski from left to right in the outfield. Parker, Hall, Starbuck, and Ferry in place of Briar Hawkins getting the start at first base today. The catcher is Adam Hackenberg. And on the hill, Sam Weatherly. He's a junior from the state of Michigan, primarily used out of the bullpen in his career. In fact, all of his 21 appearances last season were in relief. But, Tim, a guy with some exciting potential. You love the strikeouts to innings pitched. They'd love to see the walks cleaned up.
Yeah, when you look at that stat line, you kiddingly say he's a pitcher who keeps both teams in the game at the same time. He averages a strikeout and a half per inning, but he also gives up a walk per inning. So having some location will be very important. He led the Clemson team last year in opponent batting average. Opponents only hit 175 against him last year.
Monty Lee says he earned the opening day start because he probably has the best stuff on the staff and is the best leader on the team. And those are components that the Tigers head coach, as he gets ready for year number 5 of the helm, is looking for, not only in those he sends out to the hill, but all around his ball club.
Yeah, he had talked to us before the game, and Monty went on and on about the leadership of this young man.
Gray Betts out of Raleigh. All A-Sun performer in left in his own right. And a year ago, 314 batting average for a team that tends to be more of a gap-hitting group than a power ball club. They had just 35 home runs in their 43-win campaign in 2019. So here we go, and the first pitch of 2020 is delivered lefty on lefty, and it's strike one call.
Interesting to point out that the top three returning hitters for Liberty, all left-handed hitters going against the Tiger lefty.
The reverse splits are pretty good. Monty Lee pointing that out and Scott Jackson affirming that. He's got some left-handed batters that don't mind standing in there against the southpaw. 24 batted in for Betts a season ago. And he's ahead in the count, 2-1.
As you said, he was hit 314 last year. He made the preseason All-Atlantic Sun team this year. 4 players on the Liberty team made the preseason team.
And 6 of 9 starters back, and that obviously includes the designated hitter, but they thought they were going to have one of their big bats return in their first baseman, Logan Matthew, but he was lost to the season due to a knee injury. He was the conference leader in the A-Sun with 52 runs batted in a season ago, and Betts, who last year, had some pretty good walk numbers with nearly 40, draws the free pass to start things out here in 2020.
This Liberty team is excellent in terms of on-base percentage. I believe they've led the conference that they have been in the last 3 years in that category. Last year was their first year in the Atlantic Sun.
So here's Brandon Rohrer, the right fielder, out of Middletown, Delaware. And he takes strike one. Weatherly having to develop the mindset of now being a starter because they'd love to see him stay in the rotation as the season wears on. Maybe not always the Friday guy. And at the same time, Monty Lee and his pitching coach Andrew C. say they've got to develop the mindset to let him work around runners on base. And he's quickly ahead in the count here, 0-2. That's a fastball that can get up as high as 94 miles an hour on a regular basis for the left-hander Weatherly.
Throws his slider here. That's his best pitch.
Rohrer struck out 31 times a season ago. He stays alive.
But he was excellent at getting on base in terms of walks. In fact, two games last year, he had four walks in a game for Liberty that tied the school record for a single game. It was against Delaware and USF.
Weatherly, a spot starter as a freshman 2 years ago. Takes a look at the runner at first, and the count goes 1-2.
One ball, two strikes.
Betts was just 2 of 6 on stolen base tries last year. A low number on both sides. And Weatherly recording the first out of 2020. And it's a strikeout for the junior.
Fine pitch there by Weatherly right down the heart. But he kind of blew it by him. And we talked about how he averages over a strikeout per inning and a walk per inning. So we've had one of each so far.
Keeping up with the pace here in the season opener. Here's Garrett Wilkinson, DHing today, and also plays some catcher in first base out of San Antonio, Texas. Came to them from Midland Junior College, and he looks at ball one. Liberty based in Lynchburg, Virginia. They moved to the A-Sun last year after many years playing in the Big South in all their sports, but when their football program jumped from FCS up to FBS a couple of years ago, that led them to leave the Big South, and they play football now as an independent, but everything else competes in the Atlantic Sun as Weatherly falls behind in the count with ball two delivered there.
Tried to work the inside part of the plate against Wilkerson, who had 380 at the junior college level last year in Midland Junior College. He's kind of waved at that one. Another outstanding pitch by Weatherly. Got him a little off balance. The pitch was over the plate for a strike.
Betts at first does not appear to be a stolen base threat based on his numbers a season ago. And now Wilkinson ahead in the count, 3-1. One of the big holes that they have to fill in their lineup is behind the plate. Jonathan Embry was an all-A-Sun performer. In fact, he was their conference's player of the year last season. He hit 11 homers, drove home 44, and hit 312. 10th-round pick of Tampa Bay. Two men on, both via the walk here in the top half of the first inning for the Flames.
It's going to go to the number four man in the order. Will Wagner, arguably the best hitter on this Liberty Flames team. He had 326 last year. The only unanimous preseason All-Atlantic Sun selection for the preseason team of 2020.
Best power numbers coming back for their ball club. Six homers a season ago, and as noted, a team that did not hit the long ball all that much, just 35. taking ball one. After the rough patch of weather we've had in the past few weeks, mainly rain here in the upstate of South Carolina with a little bit of snow mixed in, that field looks great as Mike Eccles and his staff here at Clemson always do a great job with all the facilities. And they have had to work extra hard to the extent that the baseball team was just able to get out there earlier today on the infield for the first time in a while and work there because they had to have it covered so much.
Got the outside the corner.
Wagner is a strikeout candidate. Went down 50 times on strikes last season. And he stays alive here.
But as Liberty will do, they really work the opposing pitcher as much as they can. This will be the 20th pitch coming up. As almost got him. Just nicked it to get that foul back. As I said, this is the 20th pitch of the inning for Weatherly.
1-2. Swing and a miss. Both base runners have reached by the walk. Both outs have been recorded on swinging strike three.
Well, in talking to Monty Lee before the game, he thought Weatherly's best pitch was the slider. I think that's what he threw him here. Got him to fish for a ball that was low and outside.
Cam Locklear might be the best all-around player on this team. His numbers don't necessarily say that. 257 a year ago and four home runs, but the senior out of Lumberton, North Carolina, has started every game in his Liberty career, and he's a guy they really lean on. They come through with some clutch hits.
Yeah,
looks at ball one.
115th game. He had a great game on opening day last year against South Carolina. Had a three-run double. That was a key to their 6-5 victory in 11 innings.
First and second, two away. Catches the outside edge, and the count goes 1-1.
Weatherly got him right at the knees, got the call.
Inside corner that time. Locklear, 42 runs batted in with that 257 batting average. One, two coming from Weatherly. Called strike three, a delay call by our home plate umpire. All three outs recorded at the top of the first. Strikeouts for Sam Weatherly. Nothing across for the Liberty Flames here in the 2020 opener. And the Tigers coming to bat. Here's what the opening day lineup for the Tigers in 2020 looks like. Elijah Henderson gets a start in left field. Kier Meredith, he'll DH today. He's been under the weather a bit, or else he probably would have been in the outfield. James Parker from just down the road in Anderson. T.L. Hanna star there. He bats third at third base. Adam Hackenberg, the catcher. Big shoes to fill as Kyle Wilkie has moved on. Bo Mikowski in right field bats fifth. Chad Ferry gets the start over Briar Hawkins at first today. Sam Hall inherits the shortstop role held by Logan Davidson the past 3 years. Bryce Teodosio, third straight season as the opening day starter in center field for the Tigers. And Max Starbuck, redshirted a year ago, but had a fine offseason, says Monty Lee. He rounds out the order at second base. Betts Guy and Rohrer left to right in the outfield for the Flames. Highfill, Locklear, Wagner, and McDyer in the infield. Gulikowski, his first game as a Liberty catcher today. And on the hill, a fellow who really came on in his first season a year ago for Liberty, a left-hander, Mason Meyer. Meyer, 6-4 a year ago, got better as the season went on.
And he got a big win in the NCAA tournament over Tennessee.
Does not have a great memory of opening weekend last season, his very first game in a uniform for Liberty was in Columbia. Couldn't get out of the first inning. Henderson to left field, and that's the first hit of 2020. And Elijah Henderson leads things off.
Ball was out over the plate, and he really went with it very nicely.
Henderson, just 156 last year at the plate, but great way to start this season. So Kier Meredith, the lefty batting Tiger Jr. out of Winston-Salem, technically a sophomore, third year in the program, but a fellow who, the key for him, just stay healthy, because when he's been healthy in his Clemson career, he's been really good.
Yeah, he hit 318 last year, but only played nine games. I was actually here the game last year when he was hurt a leg. He was diving for a ball in the outfield, and I don't know that he came back after that. But he's an exciting player, 28th round draft pick of the Cubs out of high school.
Henderson at first attempted just one stolen base last season and was unsuccessful in that, but he does have good speed, and Meyer will keep an eye on him. Goes 1-1 on Meredith, who played just nine games a season ago because of those injuries, but hit 318.
With a little curveball, just went outside. The same pitch, but he smartly took it. One of the facts I love about Kier Meredith from Brian Hennessy's outstanding Clemson baseball media guide, that he started riding a bike without training wheels when he was 2 years old.
Doesn't need training wheels for his first at bat of the season either, and the Tigers have him on first and second, two men out, both with singles.
Well, similar to Henderson, the ball looked like it was out over the plate, and he waited on it nicely. And right out over the plate, belt high, and Meredith went with that pitch beautifully. And one for one. Good start to the season for the first two Tiger hitters.
James Parker saw his role increase as the 2019 season went along, a legacy in the Clemson program. In the three hole in the lineup to start things out, second base. And over to first, scored 4-6-3 on the double play. Wagner to Locklear, to McDyer, and quickly, two outs here in the home first. Pretty much made to order from Liberty's standpoint.
It was, and Liberty had him. Had their defense placed perfectly, so it was a pretty easy double play.
Parker did not ground into a double play last season.
Wagner, 56 bats. Top players, also a good defensive player, was, as I said, positioned perfectly towards second base.
Henderson moves to third. Here's the Tigers' cleanup hitter, Adam Hackenberg. One of those who will see his role grow. He's from the same hometown as Clemson basketball star Amir Sims, Palmyra, Virginia. And whereas power was kind of his thing last year, he's kind of developed more into a line drive hitter, Monty Lee tells us, during the offseason coming into 2020.
Of course, his brother was a quarterback at Penn State from 2013 to 2015. It was with the Jets. Did not get into an NFL game, but then that played in the American Alliance of Football last year for Memphis.
And the count goes 1-2. Opponents at 230 against Meyer last season.
Didn't quite get around on it. Makes it a 1-2 count.
Stays inside, count evens. That 230 batting average against, which I'm still not sure I read it right, but I checked it and double-checked it, was ninth best in the Atlantic Sun.
I wonder what they use for a minimum number of appearance. I may have a minimum number of innings to qualify. Might be a little bit higher.
Hackenberg stays alive, and he's having the kind of at-bat that Monty Lee wants to see, especially in the early weeks of the season, and what we talked about in the top half of the first inning, what Liberty has become very good at doing. And, you know, if you strike out, at least don't go down on three or four pitches. Try to extend the at-bat to put some wear and tear on the starter or the pitcher who's in there, and at least make it a valuable out. Lazy pop on the right side of the infield. Wagner calls for that. That's how things end in the home first for the Tigers. The first two men reached on hits, but nothing to show for it, and a man left stranded after one, scoreless in the opening game. You see control rooms hard at work in the Clemson Athletic Complex. It's a big weekend here on the campus. Softball, the ACC Big Ten Challenge for the first-year Tigers softball program, who had a resounding opening day a couple of days back when they split their doubleheader and got a no-hitter in their win against Western Carolina. Baseball at Liberty continues Saturday and Sunday. There's men's basketball against a Louisville team that was upset in Atlanta the other night but has a Final Four look to it. Hope you can make your way out to Tigertown this weekend. Just pick an event. You'll have a lot of fun.
Louisville ranked fifth in the nation coming in. The Tigers have a chance to record two top five wins in the same season for the first time since 1979-80, when they actually beat three top five teams at home.
And as Brady Golikowski, the catcher, takes a look at a first strike in this at-bat, who were those three teams in that 79-80 season?
Well, the Tigers beat Dean Smith as there's a swinging strike on January the 2nd, and a week later beat number one ranked Duke and Mike Jaminski, and then in mid-February beat Albert King and the Maryland Terrapins.
No swing, says the third base umpire Rusty Griffin. That wasn't the Dean Smith ejection game, was it?
No, it was not. This was the 79-80 season, which was when Hanley 93-76 behind a 22-point effort by Bruce Campbell.
And that resume got them in the NCAA tourney for the first time, where they would make
quite
a bit of noise.
Went on to the Elite Eight that year.
Payoff pitch coming to Brady Golikowski, his first at bat as the Liberty Flame, the lefty hitting catcher out of the Steel City, and he goes down swinging. Hackenberg makes it official with the tag. So the four outs recorded so far by that man, Sam Weatherly, all by way of the strikeout.
Strikeout. Not a surprise when you look at a guy that had 46 strikeouts in just 29 innings.
Lee says he and the staff, Wednesday night of this week, stayed here a long time in their meeting talking about how to construct the opening weekend pitching rotation. Weatherly was indeed the guy, and they determined, as we noted earlier, the stuff and the leadership ability of who they wanted out there, as he delivers strike one to Ben Highfill, the third baseman this afternoon for the Flames, who was primarily a DH a season ago.
Weatherly doing a good job keeping the ball down low. That one a little bit too low. He's kept the ball down so far as we go to 2-1.
Both these pitching staffs have to get used to new catchers, and it's so important for that relationship to develop for all the hurlers. And you often hear the stories, the value of a pitcher's confidence in the man behind the plate.
Absolutely.
In this era of metrics, not only from a framing standpoint, but really just the confidence to know the right pitch will be called, or if you shake off your catcher, he'll be able to respond quickly. But as was the case a couple of times in the opening half inning, another walk is issued by Weatherly, and Highfill's at first with one away.
Going to bring up McDyer, who was one of the most improved players in the Atlantic Sun last year, from his freshman year to last year. He went from 301. His freshman year was two-time conference freshman of the week, but last year he struggled, hit just 119.
Out of Priceville, Virginia, went to Loudoun Valley. Liberty team that feels like they're going to be really good again this year, and they didn't necessarily have that confidence going into 2019. They did return a starter and a reliever that could have moved on after 18, but each had injuries, so they elected to come back.
Yeah, plus they had the unknown, of course, of moving into a different conference.
And a good one at that, what is usually a multi-bid mid-major league, the Atlantic Sun. But Scott Jackson says even though they lost two out of three in their opening series against South Carolina, they left Columbia feeling much more confident about things than they did coming into the season.
Right, absolutely.
They went on to finish second in their conference.
As you said, they had seven wins over Power 5 conference teams, which is a solid number for a mid-major.
And they won their conference tournament, so they became the first A-Sun newcomer since 1993 to win the championship in their first year in the league.
Yeah, I think UCF did it that year. 3-1.
Highfield not a stolen base threat at first. And four base runners in the game so far for Liberty. All have reached by way of the base on balls. While the four outs recorded so far for Weatherly have been by strikeout.
Brings up the number nine man in the order. Jalen Guy, who hit .257 last year with one home run and 14 RBIs. And he struck out 55 times and only walked 13 a year ago.
Speedy sophomore out of Southeast Guilford High School in Greensboro. Probably played against Clemson's Kier Meredith out of Winston-Salem. As noted, Weatherly lives by the strikeout and dies by the walk, for lack of a better term. Great numbers on one side last year per innings pitch, but also a walk number that jumps out at you from 2019. 30 walks and 29 and a third. And that is laced. It'll go foul down the left field line.
Guy is the number nine batter in the order. And if you just joined us, Liberty has not hit a fair ball yet.
And they've had four base runners in one and a third inning.
Four walks, four strikeouts.
Oh, 2.
Right down the heart. Great pitch.
Two of the five strikeouts have been those caught looking.
Beautiful pitch right at the knees again. Weatherly keeping the ball down low. And that was a perfect pitch right at the knees.
First and second, but now two away. Top of the order, Gray Betts reached via walk, was left stranded in the top half of the first. Betts played at Cardinal Gibbons, good high school program in Raleigh. And he looks at ball one. Raleigh's produced a lot of great baseball players over the years, and Cardinal Gibbons oftentimes has been the alma mater of those talented guys. Lefty on lefty, and Weatherly falls behind in the count. Tinker's infield has Betts shaded to pull the ball. You see the shortstop Sam Hall closer to the second base bag than he would be for a righty batter. Sky to center. Teodosio calls off his right fielder Makowski. He'll do it for Liberty in the top half, inning number two. Once again, two walks and two stranded. Middle of the second, scoreless here at Clemson. Battle of lefties today. Mason Meyer worked through a couple of singles to lead things off in the home first for Clemson. He induced a double play from James Parker. And then got Adam Hackenberg, the Tigers' cleanup hitter, to pop out to second. You see Scott Jackson, Liberty head coach in his fourth season after spending a number of seasons as an assistant at North Carolina. So he's quite familiar with facing Clemson and coming to this ballpark. Bo Makowski, first plate appearance in 2020. First pitch swinging, center field, Jalen Guy. And he'll make the grab in the shadows just shy of the hill. Tim Bure, Pete Yannity with you on this beautiful day for opening day 2020. And based on how the weather's been of late, we are feeling quite fortunate.
It's a perfect day for football. It's a perfect day for baseball. About 55 degrees. Makowski got some pretty good bat on the ball that time. Hit it deep into the shadows in center field.
Chad Ferry getting the start at first base. I did a double take when I didn't see Briar Hawkins' name, but Monty Lee going with a sophomore lefty out of Greenwood against the left-hander Meyer.
Ferry has quite a baseball heritage in his family. His father played at Western Carolina for Jack Leggett. His uncle Burke played for the Tigers here. His grandfather, Jim Ferry, played 6 years in the major leagues. And I did a little research today. His grandfather hit 7 home runs in his career. The only person he hit more than one off of, Tom Seaver.
Wow.
2 home runs off of Tom Seaver.
Playing for the same team or with different teams?
That I don't know. Gotcha. Just had a total in the... And the other thing that was interesting, the most hits he had against one pitcher in his major league career was 9 against Bob Gibson.
Wow. 2 of the best in the National League in the 60s and 70s. Count goes full after Ferry was ahead as he chases off the plate. Lays off. And a one-out walk here in the home second.
First walk of the game for the Tiger offense. A little bit high and inside.
Meyer, 30, or I should say 33 walks in 80 and two-thirds innings pitched a year ago. Sam Hall played in various spots in the field a year ago, but he is the Tigers' opening day shortstop here in 2020. Good boy. Because he has some pop in his bat, hitting down in the order, 7 home runs a year ago, one of the team leaders returning in the power category.
Ball in the dirt. Yeah, Hall started at 5 different positions last year throughout the season, but one of them was not shortstop. This is his first career start at shortstop. Meyer a little bit of control issues. Five of his last 6 pitches have been outside of the strike zone.
Hall did strike out nearly 60 times a season ago. Looks like that'll get out of play and into the Clemson dugout. Nice effort by McDyer, but a little bit wide for his reach, and the count goes 2-1.
Hall had 30 stolen bases last year, I believe the most by a Tiger since 1994. He was 19th in the country in stolen bases.
Got to think, if this lineup develops the way Monty Lee hopes it will, that you'll see Hall probably move up in the order as the season continues, but he's the most experienced, among the most experienced batters they have. As this campaign gets underway, and the count evens at 2-2.
Slider there that ended up right over the heart.
Boy, battle. That stays alive.
Go, kid.
Once again, fouling it away.
He was right on it as the ball was fouled straight back.
Go, Fiver. Deep, baby.
Monty Lee saying with the lineup he has coming out of the box this season, you'll probably see more moving runners over in early innings, more hit and run.
Good boy.
And Hackenberg delayed steal as the ball was in the dirt. Bilikowski looked like he slipped as he was attempting. It would have been a late throw anyway. Hackenberg didn't attempt a stolen base last year and stands at second.
I think they're going to score that a wild pitch, actually.
Yep. Yeah, he was delayed in his attempt. I don't know if it was a delayed steal, but when he saw the ball in the dirt, he decided to break for second. Good job to keep it in front of him by Bilikowski.
As you said, the young man in his first career game as a catcher for Liberty.
And his coach said they really did work on him trying to get in sync with pitchers during the offseason. That was obviously a big focus. Swing and a miss. And Hall on a 3-2 count. Down on strikes. And so now Ferry stands at second base with 2 away.
That ball was going to be a called strike anyway, I believe. So just missed it. February, you'll pretty much see pitchers are ahead of the hitters for whatever reason.
First strikeout recorded by Meyer. Last season, 60 Ks in those 80 and two-thirds innings pitched, so not necessarily a strikeout hitter. Locklear, second hop on to first, and Bryce Teodosio retired to end things in the Tigers' half of the second inning. Man left stranded, two in the books. The 2020 season opener for Clemson and Liberty, and we're scoreless so far. Top of the third, scoreless game here in Clemson. Sam Weatherly gets the opening day start. Five of the six outs he's recorded have been strikeouts.
Yeah, I think in this early part here on opening day of college baseball, at this moment, he might lead the nation in strikeouts and walks. 5-4 so far, but he's not allowed a run. That's the most important thing.
And has yet to allow a hit. Brandon Rohrer, the right fielder for the Flames, who was the first to go down on strikes in the ball game in the top half of the first inning. Good job by Ferry. And that's out number one here in the third. And back-to-back balls put in play by Liberty, which is headline news based on things,
yes.
How things have started out.
That was a little bit inside and high. Got around it nicely, and Ferry did a good job staying down on the ball and making the play.
Garrett Wilkinson walked and left stranded in the top half of the first. Takes ball one. Long way from home, San Antonio, Texas, for the junior. Played at Midland Junior College, and a guy who will get work at DH and also at first base and behind the plate. Right field, it'll head out of play into the Clemson bullpen. They've enhanced the numbers, you notice, on the outfield walls here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium. All the great traditions of Clemson baseball, and they've always had various indications of that, but a new look, especially to the right field wall, pretty much from just right of center field all the way over toward the right field corner.
Yeah, I like it.
Weatherly once again ahead in the count on a batter.
He had some pop to that pitch. It was right down the heart.
Weatherly touched 96 various pitches during the offseason. But Monty Lee will tell you he's more of a 91 to 94 guy on the fastball. And what that does is set up what's become his best pitch, his slider.
Right.
Again, a 1-2. Skied high and deep, but well foul on the left field side. And hit off the top of the ice cream stand, which on a day in the high 40s is a lonely place to be.
Had home run distance. Wilkinson got around on that one.
Weatherly last season allowed just one home run in the 29 and a third innings of work.
And only three total extra base hits. Wilkerson hit eight home runs at the junior college level last year, so he's got some pop.
Now that time, swings through the 2-2 pitch, and a sixth strikeout so far for Sam Weatherly.
Oh, it's a little bit high in the strike zone, probably a pitch Wilkerson likes to hit. Again, hit some good velocity on that one.
Tigers hoping they can get about 80 pitches out of Weatherly today. He's good ways ahead of that pace, but a little bit more efficient here in the third inning. He's been out there. Walked the leadoff batter in the game, Betts, and had two on with one out in the first, and that was also the case in the second inning, but two up and two down here in the third.
That was pitch number 56.
Will Wagner struck out swinging, second baseman for the Flames of Crozet, Virginia. Chopped to short, high hop for Hall.
Wow. Must have hit a rock.
Wow, they're going to score to hit, and they well should, because not a whole lot you can do when the ball goes about 15 feet in the air in a split second, and it's first hit so far for Liberty.
Just on the second hop, looked like maybe it hit the edge of the infield. I don't know, but Manute Bowl couldn't have caught that ball.
Two-out base runner Wagner, 9 for 10 on stolen bases a year ago for the Liberty second baseman. Locklear, the shortstop, their five-hole hitter, caught looking to end the top half of the first inning. Good RBI guy for him a year ago when he drove in 42. Yep, right there on the edge.
Yeah. It's his glove, but it, you know, you couldn't anticipate that kind of a bounce. Liberty, not a team that stole a lot of bases. Last year, they were 57 for 71, compared to Clemson's 91 for 118. So they really averaged a little under a steal a game last year.
And opponents swiped 44 of the 65 bags they attempted to take. 2-0 the count now on Locklear, senior leader for this team from over in the eastern part of the state of North Carolina. Their head coach, Scott Jackson, played his college ball at Campbell. That's him on the end of the rail in the dugout. Yeah. So he has a lot of connections. Plus, he coached for many years at North Carolina in Chapel Hill. So he does recruit the Carolinas, especially eastern North Carolina, pretty hard.
Yeah,
a bunch of guys in their team from Pennsylvania, we noticed.
Yeah, we have four players from North Carolina in their starting lineup today.
Pitch fouled away.
Swung at the 3-0 pitch.
And we've seen that a couple of times. Betts did the same thing.
Yeah.
It was the last out in the top half of the second with a couple of runners on base. Ball four, a fifth walk issued so far for Sam Weatherly. So some two-out action for the Flames, first and second. Bring up the catcher, Brady Gulikowski.
Yeah, the ball got away from him. High and outside. Not sure what he was trying to throw there, but Gulikowski, he struck out his first time up on a 2-2 pitch. Dirt.
Ball one delivered to the backstop for Liberty, who actually began his career at NC State but sat out that season. Then he was at Polk State Junior College a year ago, and here he is with the Flames, and he takes strike one. Interestingly, Gulikowski was a shortstop and a third baseman in high school. He was not a catcher.
Yeah, it's odd. Who comes to mind to just something like that was Joe Torre, who's a catcher and a third baseman.
Weatherly catching the outside edge ahead of the count 1-2, and he would love to get strikeout number 7 and end things for Liberty here in the third right now. And he does, called strike 3. Third batter he's got looking today, Scott Jackson, the Liberty coach. We visit with him when we come back in a scoreless game. Scott Jackson, opening day 2020 in his fourth season guiding the Flames. Fine job, especially last year when he took the Flames to the A-Sun title. Some early impressions so far with what you've seen out of your team in this ball game, Coach?
Well, I think both teams have had some opportunities. You know, both pitchers look sharp, attacking the zone. Some moments there, you know, with Sam where he's walked a couple, but, you know, when you got that kind of stuff, you know, he's dialed it back in when he needs to. I'd like to see our guys. We had a couple of bats there. We didn't take the bat off our shoulder with runners on and runners in scoring position, so we got to be better there.
Coach, you got to be pleased with where your program is. You got three outstanding leaders that are returning for your program, all hitting over 300.
Yeah, I am. I like our guys. We got a veteran team, some older players, and, you know, kind of sit back and let them play and not try to ask them to do too much. And I like where we are. I'm honored to be the coach at Liberty.
Well, you're trying to extend a winning streak for the Flames in the series today, Coach. Good luck to you as the season forges on.
All right, appreciate it, guys. Thanks.
Liberty Flames picked to win the Atlantic Sun this season after winning the conference championship. And they come in here to Doug Kingsmore today, trying for a fifth straight win in this their ninth all-time meeting against Clemson.
Yeah, they're 6-2 against the Tigers, and believe it or not, given a minimum of six games played, Liberty has the best winning percentage in the history of Clemson baseball against the Tigers.
Max Starbuck, the freshman from just down the road in Easley, will start things out here in the home third for the Tigers. After our next half inning, we'll visit with Monty Lee on this opening day of 2020. Starbuck redshirted a year ago. Monty Lee was blunt before the game and telling us he just was not ready to compete at this level after a very good high school career for his program in Easley. And in the offseason, went to work, got stronger, doesn't try to do more than he's capable of as he takes ball two. And it really has shown both through the fall and then in preseason. He was phenomenal during their fall scrimmages. And 3-0 is the count. One of the areas that he really impressed the coaching staff, Tim, was the ability to get on base.
Yeah, he had a 505 on base average in the spring and fall scrimmages, and he got on base again.
His first plate appearance for Clemson, and what do you know, he continues that trend here in the opener in 2020.
Probably taking all away. He's got that little waggle going with the bat. And the ball was high and outside.
Top of the order, Elijah Henderson led off the home first with a single. So the Tigers, the leadoff man on in two of the first three innings. Henderson, a line drive to left to Reeves. That was followed by Kier Meredith's line single to center. Tigers had things going in the home first and second, no one out, but the double play grounder by Parker, and then a pop to second by Hackenberg. Back. Starbuck, Clemson baseball fans will recognize the last name. His dad, Greg, for the first four seasons with Monty Lee, was a volunteer assistant and a third base coach, but Greg Starbuck has since moved on to take a full-time assistant coaching job at UNCG in the Southern Conference. So a great opportunity for him, and obviously a great opportunity for his son. Now the starting second baseman at Clemson, as Henderson got a piece of that. Meyer heading the count 0-2. One strikeout so far for the Liberty left-hander out of Noonan, Georgia. So no doubt Mason Meyer has friends and family in attendance today. Not a bad drive at all from that city located just a little bit outside of Atlanta. Right field, a few steps back on it, is Rohrer, and that's out number one. So Henderson now 1-for-2 on the afternoon. Kier Meredith, lefty-on-lefty matchup, but no problem when he stepped to the plate in his first appearance of the season in inning number one. He had a sharp single to center. Doing just what his coach said we would see a lot out of, trying to get some action going, playing some small ball.
Yeah, he had the third baseman Highfield back a bit. He's going to take advantage of it. I think he's going to move in a little closer.
See the defensive set now with Highfield in on the grass. They'll chase Starbuck back to first. Nice turnout here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium on Valentine's Day to open this 2020 campaign. Have a little feature with some of the Clemson players weighing in on Valentine's Day a bit later on. Perhaps we could all learn something.
Maybe.
That will show to you during our program today on the first hit batter of the year here. Meredith will trot down to first.
Care didn't exactly jump to get out of the way of that one.
Hit by a pitch a couple of times last year in just 22 at-bats. And roughly 30 plate appearances. So now first and second and just one away. And I bring up the third place hitter, Parker. Scott Jackson apparently disagrees with Danny Everett's call behind the plate. And the Liberty skipper retreats to his dugout.
Said, did you ever see any video of Dick Dietz and Don Drysdale back in the 1960s?
And chances are Danny Everett, who probably is nowhere near that age, responded in the negative.
A lot of people watching this aren't. You might have to explain that.
Exactly. I could have also mentioned Ron Hunt, who was legendary for doing that, or one Don Baylor, all-time hit-by-pitch leader who knew how to lean into one.
But in 1968, I believe Don Drysdale was trying to set the record for consecutive scoreless innings. And he hit Dick Dietz in the inning that would have broken the record and would have ended it short of the record.
Parker swings through the pitch.
That was with the bases loaded. The umpire said, nope, Dick Dietz didn't get out of the way. Come back to at bat. And then he proceeded to get Dietz out, and he went on to set the record. But if the umpire hadn't made Dick Dietz go back to the plate, it would never have happened.
1-1 to Parker, center field, and moving over to grab it is Guy. Looked like it might drop a little quicker than that. Two away, and remain on first and second. And Adam Hackenberg popped out to second base his first time up, the Tigers catcher. Opportunity to deliver in the early going.
Got a little bit under it. He did a good job going with the pitch, but not putting just the fly balls. We can see the wind today, kind of a crosswind from right to left. Rarely does the wind blow out here at Kingsmore Stadium.
Hackenberg trying to become more of a line drive hitter this season.
Kind of out in front of a pitch that was outside. Not much wind right now. It was blowing a little bit earlier.
Good speed at second in Starbuck. And also at first in Meredith. And the count evens at 1-1.
Myers' 15th pitch of the inning and his 43rd of the game.
And he's having to count 1-2. And again, they'll stretch him out as the season goes on, but they're hoping to get five. His head coach jokingly told their radio guy in the pregame interview that, you know, maybe six and maybe seven, but obviously you're careful with pitchers earlier in the year.
Right. Hackenberg deep in the box.
Right field, and good jump on it by Rohrer. He's able to snag it for out number three. That got folks here at Doug Kingsmore excited. We'll visit with Monty Lee when we come back. Three in the books in a scoreless game. Tigers head coach Monty Lee beginning season number five at the helm. You're looking for quality at-bats out of your guys. Give me the assessment so far.
Well, so far, I feel like we've been doing a good job. We had some tough luck there in the third. Parker lined out to center field. Hackenberg did a good job with two strikes right there, hammering the ball to right field. But, you know, tough luck hit it right at him. But, you know, so far, I feel like we put some pretty good swings on the baseball, have done a good job. So far, we just can't come up with that hit with runners on base quite yet, but we are making good, solid contact, and, you know, hopefully that can continue.
Coach, your impressions of Weatherly so far, looks like he's got some pretty good stuff.
Yep, it's about like we thought. So, you know, we just big key for Sam is just being able to get to strike one. And, you know, we got to just find a way, you know, to get some guys out within 2 to 3 pitches. It'd be nice, you know, just we're getting a little bit too deep per at bat. He's having some success with the punch out, but we got some walks too. So, you know, hopefully he can have a quick inning here. That'd be good.
Coach, with so many young guys, confidence, I would think, is going to be a key topic for you and the staff, especially to work on as the early weeks of the season can continue here.
I mean, the big thing is just be consistent. You know, just understand that this is a group of kids that are going to compete. Our guys compete hard. You know, it's a selfless group, but we got to be patient with them. We've got to try to build their confidence, and we got to stay calm and consistent with them.
Monty Lee going for career win milestone of sorts today, 444 wins in his 12th season as a head coach in Division I college baseball. So he can get number 445 today. Back in 2018, he reached the 400-win plateau. Sam Weatherly is opening day starter here in 2020. And he faces Ben Highfill, who hits one high and deep to right center field and hit off the base of the wall. Teodosio up with it. Highfill has the game's first extra base hit, a leadoff double here in the Liberty fourth inning.
Yeah, certainly the best hit for either team so far in the game. And once again, he went with the pitch beautifully. The right-handed batter against the left-handed pitcher, and it was out over the plate. Teodosio, Clemson's best outfielder, could not catch up with it.
Really jumped off the bat for Highfill. Slugging percentage was just .284 a season ago, but he was really good over the final 20 games when he hit better than .300 as a DH. Eighth place hitter in the order is Trey McDye, the first baseman today for the Liberty team. Hits are now even at 2 apiece. Weatherly hopes to keep it a scoreless ball game and gets ahead in the count 0-1. 7 strikeouts so far for the Tigers' left-handed junior. But 5 walks, and McDye, as you saw, earned one of those. And looking to bunt, and he was hit by the pitch. And so back to second will go Highfill. And now first and second as McDye trots on down to first base.
Yeah, he squared around a bunt to try to get the runner to third base. With less than 2 out, pitch got away from Weatherly. Just in the right foot. Well, Monty wanted some at-bats that didn't have a lot of pitches. Well, he's done that. He's thrown just 2 pitches the last 2 guys, but they've both gotten on base.
Weatherly hit 3 batters a season ago. Dyer in a rough 2019 campaign was not hit by a pitch last year, so some activity now in the Clemson bullpen.
Jeffrey Gilbert.
The left-hander will start to work. Ninth place hitter, but a speedy batter. And a guy who has a little bit of pop in Jalen Guy, but looking to bunt. Get over the screen behind home plate, out of play.
Yeah, if they were trying to bunt him over from second, he's certainly going to try to bunt him over in first and second with nobody out. Both managers have to feel that runs are going to be at a premium, as they usually are early in the season.
Guy at .257 a year ago. Lays down the bunt, throw to third, and they get the force. I believe it was Hackenberg from behind the plate who told his pitcher to try to get the force out, and Weatherly throws to Parker for out number 1. That's big. Keeps him at first and second, but now with 1 away.
Weatherly is a lefty, falls a little bit off the mound towards that direction, and easy to pick it up and throw it over to third to get the force easily.
Top of the order, Gray Betts 0-1. He walked to lead off the game in the first. Flied out to the center fielder, Teodosio, in the third. But a year ago, he proved to come up big in these situations. A 314 hitter. 24 batted in. And nearly a 350 slugging percentage. Although he did not hit a home run. And a second hit batter of the inning by Weatherly. And they're full with just one away here in the Liberty fourth.
Take a look at this pitch. Looked like it might have been a slider that didn't slide. Similar to Meredith, he didn't exactly jump out of the gym to get out of the way.
But no protest, at least not in terms of Monty Lee walking out to talk to our home plate umpire, Danny Everett. So the bags are full, just one away. And Brandon Rohrer got a good jump on that fly ball to end the Tigers' home third with men on. Hard grounder to Ferry at first his last time up. That was the first of seven to go down on strikes for Liberty so far today. And he falls behind here, 0-2.
This would certainly be a big out to get with the bases loaded. Rohrer's a guy who did well in big games last year for Liberty. He had three hits and a win against Virginia Tech. Three hits in the conference championship game against Stetson and three hits in their NCAA tournament game against Tennessee last year.
Liberty, one of the northern teams in the Atlantic Sun, which has four Florida teams, and it speaks to how good they are at baseball. Weatherly wanted the call and a second out, but Danny Everett says ball one. Just off the outer edge and maybe a little bit low. Another good program in their conference not located in the state of Florida is Kennesaw State, just outside of Atlanta,
right,
which came in here and played in Doug Kingsmore a season ago. That time called strike three, and a big moment to get strikeout number eight for Weatherly.
Well, that's the eighth strikeout for Weatherly, the fourth that has been a called strike.
So he believes in balance. And you could say the same thing for the fact that he's walked five guys so far, too, and two have reached by getting hit by a pitch in this inning. So
he's got that 8-5 ratio, which is similar to his 46-30 ratio for the entire season last year.
Seven of the nine base runners have reached by either walk or hit by a pitch. What's the name of Charlie Sheen's character in Major League? Nuke Logan?
Yeah.
I think, yeah. So a veritable Nuke Logan.
Yes.
Or am I mixing that with Bull Durham?
Nuke LaRouche?
Yeah, there was a nuke in there somewhere. Anyway,
there somewhere.
Take the Tim Robbins character from Bull Durham and Charlie Sheen's from Major League, and maybe you've got that left-handed version in Sam Weatherly, but that pitch delivered a ball to Eric Wilkinson. Struck out swinging his last time up, walked in the first. DH and third place hitter with the bags full, but now two away for Liberty in the top half of the fourth. 1-2 the count.
Liberty has been patient, but Weatherly's gotten a lot of called strikes right there. See if he could end the inning. This would be something to get out of it after giving up that leadoff double.
Certainly would be a confidence builder.
Ooh.
Oh, he wanted the call that time, but it stays outside. The count evens up at 2-2. Wilkinson almost chased.
Eight strikeouts for Weatherly, but none when he's gone three balls on a batter. See if he can do it here in full count with the bases loaded.
Runners will be on the move. And ball four in the first run of the season against the Tigers on the sixth walk in the game for Weatherly. RBI for Wilkinson. Liberty has the 1-0 advantage as McDyer comes across the plate.
And just had a little bit too much break to it at the end. brings up Wagner, their best player.
Second baseman, unanimous preseason all-A-Sun pick, and he falls behind 0-1 here.
Opening day last year, he had a home run with two out in the ninth inning to force extra innings at South Carolina.
Wagner had the first hit in the game for the Flames. Hackenberg quickly finds it on a hard chop that caught the edge of the grass, cut out of the infield near second base, went right over the head of Sam Hall, the Tigers' shortstop, last inning.
It's got to be a terrible feeling for a catcher when he doesn't know where the ball is.
Guy at third, Betts at second, and Wilkinson at first for Liberty. Here comes a 1-1 pitch to Will Wagner. Left field. Two steps back is Henderson. And Weatherly escapes with no further damage. Flames get the first run of the game here in the fourth. Not a bad way to spend a Friday afternoon. Beautiful day, maybe just a little bit cool as the afternoon wears on, but a great turnout. You know, when the left field stands are filled up here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium, you've got a great opening day crowd on a busy weekend here at Clemson. A whole lot of things going on diamonds and courts as well.
Yep, Big Ten teams and ACC teams, and looking forward to the basketball game tomorrow. I'll be over there for that on the call with Don Munson on the Clemson Radio Network.
Things start out here in the fourth inning. The Tigers down 1-0 against this Liberty team out of the A-Sun. Bo Mikowski, first pitch swinging. He came to the plate in the second inning. He flied out to center field. Here he threw that pitch and falls behind in the count. 0-2 now. Mason Myers staked to a 1-0 lead here in the fourth. Mikowski looks like right field is his for the foreseeable future. Had a good season last year, was a catalyst at times. Ended up hitting just below 250, four home runs and 24 batted in 2019. What proved to be somewhat of a reserve role, but here he's caught looking. Second strikeout so far for Meyer, who's not necessarily known as a strikeout pitcher.
With a breaking ball, that is the second strikeout. First caught looking. I'm Chad Ferry, the Tiger first baseman.
Walked his first time up. And confidence shown in the good offseason he had, and the fact that the Greenwood native, sophomore, getting a start against a left-hander here in the opener. With Briar Hawkins, of course, also a big part of the Tigers' story at first base. Of course, also out of the lineup today, Davis Sharp, perhaps as much because he's the starting
pitcher tomorrow. Yeah.
So an opportunity for Sharp to just focus on charting pitches today and getting acclimated to this Liberty lineup from the dugout.
Meyer has his best inning going right now. Already got a strikeout, 0-2 of the next batter.
Ferry hit 175, but with three home runs and 10 batted in a season ago. And his opposite number will take care of him as McDyer records out number two.
Except Sam Hall, the Tiger shortstop.
Struck out swinging in the second. Hall is one of those players that will really be looking to step up, not only in performance. He was pretty good last year, 257 with seven home runs and 32 batted in. But as a junior, he is one of the leaders on a team that has just two seniors on its roster.
Now, yeah.
Granted, we'll often see the senior class being one of the smaller groups on a college baseball team, but more times than not, no matter how talented the rest of the squad is, usually this Clemson program is
deep.
About half a dozen. Deep left center field. Guy back, and he'll watch it sail out of here. Sam Hall delivering the first home run of 2020 for the Tigers, and we're even at one apiece.
That ball looked like it was a little bit high in the strike zone, and Hall timed it perfectly for his 10th career home run.
Two out. Thunder for the Tigers. It really jumped on the pitch, Tim.
He really did, yeah. Perfect timing. Out over the plate. Right in his sweet spot. And, you know, Sam has had some pop in his bat. He had two home runs in a game last year against Duke. Won the Bob Bradley Award as Clemson's most valuable player in the series against South Carolina a year ago.
Bryce Teodosio looking to bunt for a base hit at strike one. Tigers hit 82 home runs last season, hit right in the neighborhood of 100 the year before, so nearly 200 home runs out of this Clemson lineup past couple of years. And, of course, you go back a couple of years before that, and you had the home run threat whenever you stepped to the plate in Seth Beer.
Right.
But this is a different lineup, at least right now. This is not going to be one that relies on the long ball as the previous few seasons.
Yeah, the Tigers had two players with 16 home runs last year, Davidson and Beard. And some others that contributed to that. Teodosio is up now.
He's got the speed to beat that kind of a grounder out, and he will. Bryce Teodosio, as Wagner had him played back. So an infield hit for Teodosio, a two-out base runner. He'll take him any way he can get him. He's another guy they're counting on to step up. He's been a fantastic defensive center fielder since he got here, and he's shown some pop as Teodosio. 9 home runs last year, but this is the year they hope he cuts down on the strikeouts and ups the on-base percentage.
Yeah, good fielding play over there by Wagner. Did all he could. Teodosio's got some speed, and yeah, he does has 13 career home runs. He actually has more career home runs than any other Tiger on the roster. But he'll take a swinging bunt infield hit anytime.
And a threat to run, 8 for 12 on stolen base tries last season. Max Starbuck, his first game as a Clemson starting second baseman, walked in his very first Tiger at bat his last time up in the third.
That last pitch was a beautiful pitch there by Meyer, one of his best of the game. Right on the corner.
Back.
They've got the scouting report on Teodosio. And they will keep him close with two outs and one in on the Sam Hall homer as the Tigers answer back. That Liberty run in the top half of the inning. Saw opponents sweep 27 of 45 bags on them a year ago. Stays away, and the count evens on 1-1 against Starbuck, who played at Easley High School. So, Tim, no doubt during his prep career, he faced a high school called Liberty. And here he is in his first college game against
so.
A college called Liberty. Runner goes. Popped on the left side. Third baseman Highfill has room. And the side is retired in the home fourth, but Sam Hall delivering the big blow, a two-out solo homer to tie us up at one after four. New pitcher for the Tigers, Jeffrey Gilbert, the freshman out of Charleston, so a debut for the Tiger left-hander on in relief here to start the fifth inning of Sam Weatherly. Close the book on Weatherly, allows one run on two hits. He was great in the strikeout category, 8 of those, but he did end up walking 6 Liberty Flames, hit a couple of batters. But you look at it, he escaped his opening start, just one run allowed. And now Gilbert, Tigers stay on the left side coming out of the bullpen. We'll try to keep things right here.
Yeah, we figured he probably, the last inning was his last inning. Monty told us he would probably go about 80 pitches. I had him for 87 pitches in his 4 innings of work.
Cam Locklear, the senior shortstop, is who the Tiger freshman gets to see in his collegiate debut, the first batter he'll face. Out of the fine program at Bishop England is Gilbert, and he delivers ball one.
Yeah, had a pretty decorated high school career. He was the Gatorade Baseball Player of the Year in South Carolina as a junior and named Mr. Baseball in South Carolina as a senior.
A program that regularly competes for state championships in its classification, Bishop England. 1-1 the count on Locklear, who was caught looking in the first and walked and was stranded in the third inning. Rips it on the left side and just fair. Took up some chalk as it goes into the corner. Henderson will get it back in, and Locklear a leadoff double in the fifth inning. In fact, that's how the fourth inning began for the Flames.
It did. It took them a while to get that run in. Locklear pulled that ball right down the line, just fair by a foot. Makes a nice turn at first and heads into second with a stand-up double.
Eight doubles in 2019 for Locklear. And good speed. Now at second base for the catcher, Gulikowski. Went down swinging and went down looking in his two appearances against the Tigers starter, Weatherly.
Nice breaking ball there by the left-hand pitcher against the left-hand batter.
Says a lot about Gilbert than a 1-1 game in the fifth inning. Monty Lee has confidence to give him his collegiate debut against a very good opening weekend opponent, Liberty. You'll hear about them all season long. And they've got a chance to, again, win their conference and get back to the NCAA tourney. Trying to win for the seventh time in nine meetings all time against Clemson. And the count goes 3-1.
93 on the gun there. That gets a good pop.
Scott Jackson, longtime North Carolina assistant coach. Back in 2008, he was Liberty's pitching coach. Knows this neck of the woods well. Played at Campbell over in Buies Creek, North Carolina, near Fayetteville, though collegiately as a player, he never competed against Clemson. Occasionally over the years, I believe the Tigers have probably seen Campbell.
Yeah,
in a few
and
games.
When he was at UNC Wilmington, the basketball coach was Brad Brownell.
Some different connections for the Liberty head coach. Payoff pitch coming to Gulikowski, and that's ball four. First and second, no one out here in the fifth for the Flames.
Getting himself in a little bit of trouble here in his first inning of work.
Ben Highfill has walked and doubled. He led off the fourth with the second hit in the ball game for the Flames, and essentially cut down at third on an attempt to move him over as Weatherly came off the hill and made a nice throw to Parker to get him for the first out of that inning. Highfill a 219 hitter last season, but he was really good over their final 20 games, and he takes strike one.
Ian going with a breaking ball.
.27 batted in during the 2019 campaign for Highfill. Out of Apex, North Carolina, in the Raleigh area.
Yeah, Coach Jackson has a lot of ties, of course, to the state of North Carolina when he was at UNC Wilmington.
Hey, Jackson, 107 victories in his first 3 years guiding this Liberty team.
Including 43 last year that tied a school record for a season.
Liberty is the alma mater of a fellow who has a special place in Atlanta Braves fans' hearts. Strike two, count evens at 2-2. One Sid Bream played his college baseball there. Also had a pitcher named Lee Gooderman back in the 90s, head of the major leagues. Another lefty, played just a little bit in the early 90s with the Pirates and a few other teams. Randy Tomlin, those are the more famous baseball alums they have. Off speed, stays high. The count goes full at 3-2.
Big pitch coming up here. He went 3-2 in the last batter and walked him. You did not want to walk. The base is loaded and nobody out.
Six Flames have reached via free passes, all those by Weatherly over the first four innings. Swing and a miss.
Big strikeout.
89 miles an hour on the fastball. The first out recorded in his career by Gilbert. His first career strikeout and out number one here in the Liberty fifth.
You got him with a high hard one. Probably would have been ball four. Had some real rise on it there.
Ninth strikeout by Tiger pitching. Trey McDyer scored the game's first run. Reached on a hit-by-pitch in the fourth and eventually came around on the bases-loaded walk to Wilkinson.
He also walked in the second.
Looking to hit the barrel to bat on the ball here, first and second, but now one away. As the Flames try to respond to the Tigers' run on the Hall solo blast in the home fourth. And Gilbert ahead in the count, 0-2.
Good pitch, even a little tailed a little bit away from the batter.
Dyer struck out 17 times in 50 plate appearances a year ago. Doesn't chase the 0-2 in the count, 1-2.
As I said earlier, he had a great freshman year in 2017. He hit over 300, was two-time conference freshman of the week.
Gilbert delivers, 1-2. Doesn't get far enough away from Hackenberg for the runners to advance. Locklear is at second base, got good speed. Over at first for Liberty is Gulikowski. He's the catcher, so we'll leave it there in terms of what kind of wheels he has.
You never saw Manny Sanguin play?
Biggio was a speedster when he was a catcher.
Yeah.
Eighth place hitter in the order, the first baseman today for the Flames. Trey McDyer awaits the 2-2 pitch. Got a piece.
Two balls, two strikes. Similar pitch to what he struck Heifel out. Kind of a high, hard one. A little rise to it.
Either side has been retired in order so far, and obviously this is an extended inning for Gilbert on a relief of Weatherly. Swing and a miss. Got him to chase. Two strikeouts after the first two men reached in the inning.
Kind of got him to wave at a bad pitch. Would have been ball three.
As the pitchers struck out 521 batters a year ago. They have 10 so far today in 4 2/3 innings. Ninth place hitter Jalen Guy, but not an easy out. He's got good speed, so any chopper on the infield, he'll have a good chance to reach. And guys ahead in the count, 2-0, drove home 14 a season ago.
Guys from Greensboro, one of those four starters from the state of North Carolina for Liberty.
Three and oh the count. There is a base open, but you got the leadoff hitter waiting on deck in Betts, so Gilbert would just as soon come back and get Guy. And
it's going to be the 25th pitch of the inning for Gilbert.
Four pitch walk, and they are loaded with two men out. And for a second straight inning, Liberty has the bags full. Second walk in the inning issued by Gilbert and in the game. Eight Flame batters have reached on the free pass.
Come on. That happened to me.
Top of the order. Betts has been on base twice. Walk and a hit pitch around a pop out to center. In inning number two, and takes the off-speed pitch for strike one. Good start in the lefty-on-lefty matchup, and Gray Betts, an all-A-Sun outfielder for this Liberty team.
Must have caught the corner early.
Yeah. Counts 1-1. Betts a 314 hitter last season. Showed a good eye, had nearly 40 walks.
Breaking ball in the dirt. We've seen Liberty batters fish at those, however.
Gilbert, the freshman. That's a sophomore. And it's the Tigers lefty who's ahead in the count. 1-2, trying to strike out the side around a leadoff double and a walk that followed. Moments ago, the walk to Guy to load the bases. Off speed, weak grounder, Ferry, no problem. And Gilbert walking out of a jam in his first Clemson appearance. It remains a 1-1 game here in the middle of the fifth. With Tim Bray, Pete Gannady with you back at Doug Kingsmore Stadium. Opening day 2020 for the Clemson Tigers and Liberty Flames. Head to the bottom half of the fifth inning in a 1-1 game. A single tally in the top half of the fourth by Liberty, followed by Sam Hall's solo homer in the bottom half of that fourth inning for Clemson. Scott Jackson, the Liberty coach, before the game commenting that something that distinguishes Doug Kingsmore Stadium from most other venues in college baseball, the fans, a knowledgeable fan base here at Clemson. A good turnout of Tiger fans today for the opening game as Elijah Henderson, the left fielder from just outside of Greer and leadoff hitter in the lineup for Clemson this afternoon, will come up for the third time today. He started things in the first with his first single of the campaign, flied out to right his last time up in the third. Mason Meyer, a junior in his second season in this program for the Liberty Flames, working into the fifth inning. And he delivers strike one to Hall. A 4 o'clock local time start here at Doug Kingsmore today, so perhaps things will time perfectly for any mid-evening dinner reservations made. And coming up right after this half inning, we've got a Valentine's Day feature that we are promised will be enlightening, and the folks in the control room are, I dare say, Tim, giddy about the presentation.
They're very excited.
Valentine feature.
Very excited.
We'll have that for you as the count's 3-1 on the former standout at Blue Ridge High, where he was a Tiger, and now he's the Tigers opening day left fielder, and Elijah Henderson has a leadoff walk here in the fifth inning. Just the third issued by Meyer so far.
Definitely inside. See the Tigers get the leader, lead batter on base for the third time in five innings.
Mike Henderson, Kier Meredith owns one of Clemson's four hits. Last time up, he was hit by a pitch and left stranded. That was in the third. They'll chase Henderson back. He's got good speed. 0 for 1 on stolen base tries a year ago, but limited opportunities. Meredith offers, and it's strike one. As you see, the shadows now pretty much covering up the infield as the sun begins to set, approaching 6 p.m. And we've had a wind blowing pretty much from right field over towards center for most of this game, but when night time comes upon us here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium, the wind tends to just die.
Yeah.
One of the really interesting phenomenons when you have a late afternoon start here, you can be playing in the windiest of conditions, but as soon as it's dark out, suddenly there's no more wind. Second base, Wagner, fast man running. They get the lead runner at first, but Meredith able to avoid the double play. Good hustle by the Tigers. Redshirt sophomore, so one away, still a man at first, and now it's Meredith.
Looks like he got fisted a little bit on that one. And didn't make it by much, but he did make it.
James Parker grounded into a 4-6-3 double play in the first and then flied out to center field his last time up in the third.
Son of former Clemson pitcher Tim Parker, who pitched for the Tigers between 87 and 90.
Sophomore out of T.L. Hanna in Anderson. So
we actually have an interesting run in the lineup here from the 3, 4, 5, and 6 batters. You have the son of a Clemson player. You have the brother of a Penn State quarterback, the son of a Green Bay Packer quarterback, and the grandson
of a major leaguer. Who Bob Gibson and Tom Seaver did not do well
against. Yeah. Yes.
1-1 the count on the first of that legacy foursome that makes up the middle of the Tigers batting order today. Remember Parker, about a third of the way into last season, suddenly started getting some playing time and made the most of it for this Clemson team. Meredith, a threat to steal at any moment, is chased back.
Parker had 3 hits in a game against Louisville on April the 7th. Hit a home run against East Tennessee State.
And they've got him picked off. Throw to second. Locklear couldn't handle it. The shortstop. And Meredith in there safely. I'm not so sure that the throw didn't have to be perfect to get him. He got such a great jump.
He did. You're right.
We're going to call it a E6 because our official scorer thinks, and correctly so, that Locklear should have made the grab.
But made the grab.
Tigers with one away. Now a man in scoring position looking to take their first lead of the ball game, and a speedy one at that in Meredith. Counts 1-1 on the batter, Parker.
In case you're wondering, one of the inside baseball in stats, the first baseman actually gets an assist.
Yes, he does.
On that play.
Well, they call it a caught stealing because they did technically get him as he was going, and the error, you can assume without it, they would have had the out. For those of you keeping score at home.
Yes.
2-2 count now on Parker.
Which fewer people do than they used to because you can go online and call up all the scoring you want.
But, of course, when keeping score, A, don't do it on a tablet, do it in a scorebook, and you use a pencil, not a pen.
I know. I didn't bring a pencil today, so I'm violating one of Bob Bradley's main rules of scoring.
With this being opening day, I was forgetful of sharpening as Meredith goes again, popped up on the right side. Wagner calls for it. Meredith will have to hustle back to second. He'll get there, still draw a throw, and now two away. I was concerned leaving the house today that I hadn't sharpened my two pencils because you always have to have a backup, but fortunately they still had some sharpness to them. So Meredith did a great job. He got a great jump. It looked like he would have the bag swiped almost all the way to third.
I was going to say, doing the shuttle run.
He had to run as hard that time to beat the throw by Wagner as he did when he They had him picked off as he was trying to steal second and ended up there as a result of the error by Locklear.
He probably would do well at the NFL Combine in the shuttle run.
Adam Hackenberg trying to deliver in a key situation here in the fifth inning. Man in scoring position and two outs.
Too bad, because I think Meredith would have stole third base.
Absolutely, and a liner off the glove of Locklear. Meredith will come around. The Tigers have their first lead in 2020. Hackenberg, his first RBI. They're going to score it an RBI single for the Tigers sophomore.
It will be an unearned run, however.
Locklear's heading it. Venturous, bottom of the fifth in the field at shortstop for Liberty. There was no way that Betts had any chance and left to cut down Meredith.
Now with two out, Meredith was off and running.
Bill Mikowski 0 for 2, first pitch swinging in the second. He flied to center, and then he was caught looking. His last time up, one of two strikeouts recorded by Mason Meyer, the lefty, who now finds himself trailing for the first time this afternoon. And we notice down the left field line there is some activity in the Flames bullpen. Meyer would like to get the final out and maybe go plead his case in the dugout, but his pitch count is climbing, so no guarantees we'll see him in the sixth inning, even if he's able to work out of the jam. Appeal to third, and it's a 1-1 count. Good job to hold up by Mikowski.
That was his 70th pitch for Meyer. Nice curve for a strike.
Count even at 2-2.
Yep. Perfect pitch.
Hackenberg at first. Fly to right. Roar. And the inning is over. Tigers, though, able to push across the go-ahead run. Single runs in the past two innings and a 2-1 Clemson advantage. Back next to my longtime friend and colleague with Tim Bray, Pete Yannity with you. 2-1 game as we head to the sixth inning. Tigers with single runs in the fourth and the fifth to get their first lead of 2020. So Valentine's Day, and well, obviously duty called for us, Tim. But in case that we have viewers who are looking for some insight, we have that opportunity in a feature we have for you. We'll get to that in a moment. But just impressions out of this Tigers team over the first few innings we've seen.
Well, it's kind of been a typical early season game. Obviously, it's a season opener. Usually the pitchers are ahead of the hitters. We've seen a lot of strikeouts. Clemson staff has 10 strikeouts already through five innings. And they've done just enough here to offensively to pick a one-run lead. Nice home run, though, by Hall.
As for that Valentine's feature, here it is, courtesy of some Tigers players.
If we're going in the DMs, so you got to go slide in the DMs. You got to send a emoji of a dog. Then you got to go, hey, Max, come back here. And after that, you got to be, hey, I'm sorry, just wanders off in random places.
What's up, good looking?
If you're a triangle, you'd be a cute one.
Does your left eye hurt? Because you've been looking right all day.
I'm not a photographer, but I can picture me and you together. Are you Australian? Because you meet all my qualifications.
Do you believe in love at first sight, or do I need to walk by again?
Are you from Tennessee? Because you're the only ten I see.
Are you a parking ticket? Because you got fine written all over you. Is your name Wi-Fi? Because I'm feeling a connection.
Take them to a little wine factory, you know, have a little wine and dine there, then maybe go out and see a sunset, maybe at White Beach, you know, that's a good little place to go.
I'm going to like every baseball stadium in the country and eating very carelessly.
Cookout.
Does Ruth Chris get a nice steak?
I'm definitely going to Chuck E. Cheese and just renting out that place for a day.
Nice dinner.
movie after, and with some nice scenery.
Turks and Caicos, just go sit out on a boat with my girl.
Bora Bora, steak on the beach.
So there you go. Thanks to the Tigers for lending some insight. We hope you learned something. Brandon Rohrer to right field. Bo Mikowski is over, and I believe Bo was one of the players we saw giving Valentine's advice, and he could probably give a tip or two on how to run down a ball that's breaking away from you to the right field line.
He got a nice jump on that ball. The ball was well hit, but he got right over there, showed the probably better speed than his father showed when he was a quarterback for the Green Bay Packers.
Who also faced the Tigers as a
faced the Tigers in Virginia, you're correct.
Second inning of work for the freshman for the Tigers. Jeffrey Gilbert, who worked out of a jam unscathed in the Liberty half of the fifth inning. First two batters reach, but he got a couple of strikeouts and induced a two-out slow grounder to first off the bat of Betts to not allow a run.
Yeah, Gilbert threw 29 pitches in that first inning. Not more than he wanted to, but he did get a couple of strikeouts.
Jared Wilkinson awaits the 1-1 pitch. Reached twice via walk, and he's also struck out. So Weatherly, the Clemson starter, had an adventurous, if not suspenseful, first four innings of work in which he retired eight via strikeout, but also yielded his fair share of walks, six in all.
They threw 87 pitches in four innings. Just about right on it. Fouled it off. He's got some pop. Eight home runs last year at the junior college level out in Texas.
San Antonio native's debut with Liberty. Their DH today also catches and plays first. 2-2 pitch. Count goes full on the third place hitter in the Liberty lineup. Payoff pitch, high and deep to left, but well foul. Saw a similar drive earlier in this game off the bat of one of the Liberty hitters. Gilbert out of Bishop, England in Charleston. So he has played at a very high level because they not only compete within the South Carolina High School League, but Bishop, England faces a lot of schools from the Southeast region, as many of the public schools do in South Carolina early in the campaign. Sam Hall. And that's out number two here in the Liberty half of the sixth inning.
Ball was not hit that hard, but had to stay with it. And could it be? Could we have our first 1-2-3 inning of this game for either team?
Will Wagner will have something to say about that. Best hitter in the Liberty lineup, a consensus preseason All-Atlantic Sun Conference pick. And it looks like strike one, off-speed pitch.
Liberty did have four players on that preseason Atlantic Sun team. Two of them pitchers, neither of whom have appeared in this first game of the series.
Yeah, their ace, Noah Skirauer, righty, goes tomorrow. Little chop over the mound, charging his Hall, gloving, throwing, and, well, at first, Ferry unable to hold on to it. Let's see how they score it, and it's two-out base runner.
Welcome to the announcer's jinx.
Yeah, there you go. It wasn't a free throw, by gosh.
No, it was not a free throw. He just couldn't quite get it, but get it, Gilbert.
Saw they had the shift on, so the shortstop Hall playing just to the right of the bag. Kind of had to come across at a strange angle, and it'll be an E6. So that even sings in the error category at one apiece. Wagner at first a year ago was 9-for-10 on stolen base tries. And Cam Locklear, who looks to atone for an error that led to the Tigers' go-ahead run at the bottom of the fifth, stands in. fifth place hitter in the order, the shortstop.
Both errors in today's game by the shortstops, one for each team.
Locklear led off the fifth inning with a double, was later stranded as Gilbert worked out of what eventually was a two-out, bases-loaded jam without allowing a run. Locklear played at Jack Britt High in Lumberton, North Carolina. Good fastball hitter. 91-mile-an-hour delivery. Fouls it away, and the count goes 1-1. Speed 2-1. Got to figure Gilbert's getting up there as far as his pitch count in this very first Clemson appearance out of the bullpen.
Yes, he's over 40 now. Actually, he's 42.
Wagner getting the attention of the Tigers freshman lefty.
Some pitchers have thrown at least 21 pitches in every inning so far. Trying to end that streak here. Ooh, that looked good.
3-1 now, the count on Locklear, who walked in the third inning.
I take that back. It was low.
He was caught looking to end the first inning with two men on. And now the count goes full.
It's the fourth batter that he has gone the full count with. That's why his pitch count is up there.
One of the Tiger ball girls. A tradition started here by Bill Wilhelm.
Yes.
For bat girls and ball girls. And it has continued over the years. Runner goes on the 3-2 pitch with two away. Another walk issued by Clemson pitching. And back-to-back base runners after there were two out.
One year we actually put a picture of the Batgirls on the cover holding bats. We had the slogan, Clemson's Murderers Row. Coach liked that cover.
I would think so. And visit to the mound. Andrew C., the Clemson pitching coach. Nick Clayton, a righty, is warming in the bullpen.
Another freshman.
Yeah, I was going to say another new face for this Clemson team. C's visit is done. With two outs here in the top half of the sixth inning. First and second for the Flames. Will Wagner at second reached on an error on the throw by Sam Hall, trying to get him on a chopper. On a tough play, and then the walk to Locklear. Nine walks for Liberty today. Third one issued by the freshman Gilbert.
Nine walks and 10 strikeouts.
Gilbert has two of those after
two hit batters.
Weatherly had eight Ks in his four innings of work. Lefty on lefty here. Gulikowski, the junior catcher, his debut for the Liberty team here this afternoon.
Gilbert's had a little trouble getting that slow curve over.
And once again, Hackenberg doing a nice job keeping the ball in front of him, especially with runners on first and second. Gilbert falling behind another batter.
Went with the fastball, tried to paint the corner, but could not do it.
...91 miles an hour. Filikowski couldn't catch up with that.
That was a strong pitch. Just blew it by him. 48 pitches for Gilbert in two innings.
Shot. Once again, Hall able to snag a liner. Not bad at all that time for Sam Hall. And that'll do it for Liberty. They strand two in their half of the sixth inning. Couple of line drives to Sam Hall, the story in the sixth. Garrett Price on, an all-A-Sun performer out of Evington, Virginia. So Myers' day is done. Five innings pitched, allows two runs, just one of them earned, five hits. Struck out two and walked three. As for Price, well, he's all A-Sun for a reason, and it gives you an idea of the importance of this game for Scott Jackson and Liberty on the road against the Power Five in a 2-1 game. 3.15 ERA last season, 7-3, and certainly a guy that they're going to ride quite a bit this season, Tim.
Yeah, as right. I said, they have
strikeouts to innings pitched last year. Pretty good numbers, 71 in just under 66 innings.
Two preseason all-conference pitchers. The other one we'll see tomorrow, Skiro. But you're right. You know, we posted the graphic at the beginning of the game where we said seven wins over Power Five conference teams. That's obviously huge for this program. Everything they can to try to get one today.
And they opened their campaign in 2019 in the Palmetto State down in Columbia against South Carolina with one of those seven Power Five.
Yeah.
Chad Ferry, the Tigers' first baseman, has walked and grounded out to first. And the first pitch delivered in 2020 by Price is strike one. Price 24 walks in his 65 and two-thirds innings of work, so an efficient pitcher, or so it seems, and ahead in the count 0-2.
That was a very good pitch. Well, his ball pitch almost looks like it has a screwball action. It kind of goes away from a left-handed batter.
One-two pitch. Ferry stays alive. Ferry, an opportunity today, gets the opening day start against a lefty Meyer with Briar Hawkins, the righty, entering his sophomore year off a good freshman season for the Tigers. Also, of course, a Clemson first baseman who I would suppose will see a lot of Hawkins and Davis Sharp playing first.
Right.
As the season forges along. Two-two to the leadoff man here in the Clemson six. And a good job by Ferry to work it back to a full count.
Curve was a little high and outside. Didn't miss by much, though.
Got him on an 84-mile-an-hour pitch for out number one. Sam Hall coming to the plate. Here's what he did when he last was there. Really ran into one.
He got around on a pitch that was right over the plate and get out of the park and left center for his 10th career home run. The first home run, obviously, by a Clemson Tiger this season.
That was in the home fourth. It answered a run in the top half of the inning by Liberty and tied us at one apiece. Clemson inning. And RBI single with two men out by Adam Hackenberg in the fifth as Kier Meredith came around in what was an unearned run, but the Tigers a 2-1 lead. And Hall hitting today down in the order, but you've got to think he's someone I think Monty Lee would love to have in maybe the two-hole as the season goes.
Yeah.
Even a leadoff hitter, although he can be a little bit aggressive at the plate. Ball's behind here, 0-2.
He got fooled with a curveball that time.
Lays off.
Good to have him go fishing again.
Price, another good one out of their pen. They had a pitcher last year, Evan Brabrand, who was an All-American, ninth round selection by the Marlins. Count evens a 2-2 on Hall. And again, he goes full on a batter.
After an 0-2 start, he did that to Ferry, but then he struck him out.
Came off speed to Ferry. That was a righty on lefty. Let's see what he does here. Righty, righty. And a one-out walk for the Clemson shortstop Hall, the junior out of Hampstead, North Carolina. Just the fourth walk issued by Liberty pitching in the game. And that also puts a speedy Tiger on the base pass. Sam Hall last season, 30 stolen bases in 37 attempts.
Yeah, he led the ACC in steals last year, the first Clemson player to do that since 1994.
Bryce Teodosio reached on an infield single, a weak roller on the right side of the infield his last time up. Tigers center fielder looking to take another step. I think last year he delivered the power numbers in terms of being at the plate, but he had the dubious distinction of 71 strikeouts to lead the team, and he hit 215. He has always been a plus defender. If he can get the bat working this year, he will have a big decision to make at the end of this his junior season.
Yeah, his 9 home runs leads all returning Tigers.
Teodosio, former standout at Malden, 33 batted in 2019. Plays off and the count goes 2-1.
In the dirt. Hall was the first Tiger to lead the ACC in stolen bases since Mike Hampton had 39 in 1994. Jack Leggett's first year as head coach of the Tigers.
That was a team that lost here against Auburn, or would have started a run of what would have been 3 consecutive College World Series.
Right. Actually lost to Notre Dame and then lost to Auburn.
Yeah. I remember Auburn was the deciding, or the game that ended the hope of that.
Correct.
Count now even 2-2 here in the home 6 on Teodosio. Stays off the outer edge. And once again, a third batter in the inning and a third full count for Price on in relief of the starter, Meyer.
Third straight, 3-2. That Price has gone two.
Teodosio reached base on just 16 walks a season ago. Another number he wants to get up there. Hall was on the move. There will be no throw. So back-to-back walks. That's why. So first and second now with one away.
The fastball, although it had a little movement inside, his fastball moves kind of in towards the right-handed batter, but two straight walks. Price in his career, 200 strikeouts and just 72 walks coming into this season in this game. So he's usually got pretty good control, 72 walks and 187 career innings.
Max Starbuck, the Tigers redshirt freshman second baseman, walked in his very first collegiate plate appearance in the third. Looks at one in the dirt. Golikowski's throw. It's going to get away. Hall will score easily. Teodosio will move up to third, and the Tigers able to force the action as they will so often attempt to do here in 2020, and it's a 3-1 game.
Well, the running ability of Sam Hall comes through again as he put pressure on the defense and caused that error. Good job by Teodosio going from first all the way to third.
Heads up base running by Teodosio, and Starbuck now with a man in scoring position once again, but this time at third. Liberty will bring in the infield, just one away, and now trailing by a couple of runs here in the home sixth.
Kulikowski kind of panicked on that play.
Monty Lee telling us before the game he will employ a safety squeeze more times than not this season. Well, this would be a situation to do just that.
Yeah, especially with a guy who can handle the bat like Starbuck. Teodosio, a good runner. It's 2-1 now.
And unless you're in a tie game and it's late, I've never thought a suicide squeeze is necessarily a smart move. Unless you have been able to read and figure out the signs and know exactly what's coming from the pitcher, and you have a surefire bet at the plate to make contact on the bunt try. God, even to 2-2 on Starbuck.
Yeah, probably a strike.
Price really is only himself to blame. He was ahead of Hall 0-2.
Oh, those bases on balls.
And walked him, and then he walked Teodosio on a 3-2 pitch and a strikeout. So the two outs in the inning recorded on swinging strikes by Price, but a run in and still a man on third. Now with two away and top of the order, Elijah Henderson, who's been on base a couple of times in this opening game.
Yep, it would have been a ball three, too.
Henderson walked his last time up in the fifth, led things off in the first with a single, and it's also flied to right. Delayed call by our home plate umpire, Danny Everett, for strike one. Boy, what a shot. Hits the fence in front of the Liberty dugout.
That ball was pulled so much it looked like it was going to hit Teodosio, and then it ended up against the wall.
Pretty good draw if he was trying to drop one near the pin.
Yeah.
That really moved.
Would have been a heck of a draw, yeah.
Price ahead in the count of the Tigers' leadoff hitter, Henderson, 0-2, and it'll stay that way.
Getting around on it. Price does not have the most powerful fastball. Has to finesse the guys, which obviously he's done well over his career. He's got a 19-8 career record.
Off speed. And the count stays 0-2. A run in this home sixth inning. Unearned at that for the Tigers, but we'll take them however they can get them, obviously. Hard shot, left field. It'll add a second run in the inning. The RBI single for Henderson, who's now 2-for-3 in the game, and it's a 4-1 Clemson advantage. So now that run is earned. Henderson gets his first RBI of 2020. And after Meyer allowed just one run in five innings, or two runs in five innings of work, Tigers have doubled up the score here in the sixth.
Well, that entire at bat, Henderson was getting around on Price, and he finally hit one fair to get it through the hole. But two hits today for Henderson. I think it was just 5-for-32 all of last year when he played sparingly.
Drove in five runs on the season.
Yeah, so. Great start for him in this season.
Meredith fouls away the first pitch he sees.
You know, Henderson had a really good summer playing in the Coastal Plains League for Forest City in North Carolina. He made the All-Star team up there.
So a three-run lead for this Clemson bullpen. Right now, Jeffrey Gilbert, pitcher of record on the plus side, a chance to get a win in his debut game in college for the Tigers. Interesting to see if he's back out there for the seventh inning.
He's thrown 49 pitches in two innings, so be in the seventh.
Meredith has been on base all three times he's been up in this game. Has a single and a run scored. Wind still blowing ever so slightly from right field over towards center. Two-one coming from Price. So control continues to be an issue.
Yeah, kind of a surprise.
Guy who a year ago had a really good strikeouts innings pitched and walks innings pitch ratio. Senior out of Evington, Virginia. All A-Sun performer back for a final year in a Liberty uniform, but behind to the Clemson DH here in the game. And now the count goes full.
Going to be the 34th pitch of the inning for Meredith, for Price. Good pitch there. Right on the black.
The two outs recorded in the inning, strikeouts, Ferry and Starbuck. The damage has been done with a couple in. Henderson was on the move. And we'll try it again on a payoff pitch. Two runner going, but again a walk is issued. Third in the inning by Price.
Yep, Price missed the inside corner that time, and he's really struggling. They're going to take him out. You got to wonder.
At the very least, we'll see pitching coach Matt Williams head on out to the mound. Had a feeling that night. They've just gotten some activity going in their bullpen. You see the left-hander getting loose for Liberty, and that's Mason Flaherty, freshman. So this is just a visit to try to calm down Price and try to hold things right here in a 4-1 game in the home sixth inning. Two runs in, three walks in the frame, and the Tigers in this inning have just the one hit, the RBI single by Henderson. The other run was scored on a bad throw with Hall trying to steal third after he reached on a walk and was moved up to second on a walk to Teodosio, who then came home on that Henderson hard shot through the left side with two away.
Price is going to 3-2 count on four batters in this inning.
James Parker. Tigers had things going when he came to the plate in the first inning. First and second, no one out, but the double play. And he looks at an off-speed pitch for strike one. In the three-hole today, maybe not the place he'll stay in the lineup as the year goes on, but this is a Clemson team. It'll be interesting to look in early April if the lineup looks significantly different than what Monty Lee puts out there on opening day. Chances are there may not be a guy in the same spot in the batting order that he was today. Skied on the left side. Highfill, for a second time in this game, records the final out in foul territory, the third baseman, but a productive bottom of the sixth for the Tigers. Two more runs, they lead 4-1. Nightfall descends on Doug Kingsmore Stadium as we head to the seventh inning. Tigers have a 4-1 lead with Tim Bure, Pete Yannity with you. The 2020 season opener, opening day here at Doug Kingsmore. Some of the folks who packed this ballpark at the outset have headed on home or on this Valentine's Day, perhaps needing to make dinner reservations.
Yes, absolutely. Dinner reservations, I'm sure, at some fine local establishments.
There are some who out there in right field taking advantage of the Cajun Cafe. And for the second time in this ballgame, Monty Lee has made a pitching change as the Tigers skipper tries to get his fifth campaign off on the right foot. And Sheldon Reed on for Clemson. So the Tigers will see what the next guy out there on the mound for them has to offer, the senior out of Bradley, South Carolina, and a big one at 6'3 and 205. Good work done in the debut innings for Jeffrey Gilbert. He was able to work around some trouble in both the six innings.
He threw 49 pitches in two innings. Pete, he went two innings, gave up one hit, didn't allow any runs. He did walk three and struck out two.
Ben Highfill will start things out in the Liberty half of the seventh inning. He's their third baseman today. Was one of two to go down on strikes against Gilbert in the fifth inning. And the count evens at 1-1. Highfill led off the fourth with a double, was forced out at third base, and he walked his first time up in the second inning. The bats they're hoping can step up for them in this 2020 season. A Liberty team that won the A-Sun tournament a year ago. 43 victories for the Flames in 2019. Scott Jackson, their veteran head coach. We'd love to see a leadoff man reach with his team staring at a three-run deficit.
Almost hit the corner. Could have been a little low. Good heat there. 96 according to the scoreboard.
So Reed can bring you out of the bullpen.
Just blew it right by him.
Reed on in relief of Gilbert. And he walks the first batter he faces. Now, unless there was some predetermined agreement that I'm not aware of, you would say that Gilbert right now is a pitcher of record for the Tigers to get the win. Sometimes they establish the fact that the starter, if he's ahead when he exits, is in such a position.
However, he was not. I think it was 1-1.
In this case, he wouldn't be because of a 1-1 game when Weatherly left.
And we have our 14th consecutive half inning without a 1-2-3 inning.
Leadoff man on yet again by virtue of the walk for Liberty. And now Highfill, he was hesitant. He'll scurry back as Hackenberg throws down to Ferry. By the way, that walk for Highfill, his second in the game. 10 issued, as best I can tell, by Clemson pitchers so far.
Slow one outside by Reed, who made just six appearances last year, pitched a 5 1/3 innings. Transfer from Spartanburg Methodist goes to 2-0.
Trey McDyer struck out swinging his last time up. He has scored the lone run in the game for the Flames team. Mid-90s heat that time, 95 miles an hour, but the count goes to 3-0. Taking all the way, 3-1. Tigers have a long connection to the junior college in Spartanburg, Spartanburg Methodist, and of course, their head coach, Monty Lee, with deep ties to that school. Swing and a miss. Once again, good heat. Reed has come in slinging. Strikeout candidate at the place, McDyer. Lays off, stays outside, two walks to start things in the Liberty seventh.
Not what Monty wanted to see. Up 4-1 in the seventh. And they both have been 3-2 walks, but. It was close.
Ninth place hitter, Jalen Guy, the center fielder, who's reached in his last two plate appearances, and I do believe Monty Lee has seen enough and will again go to the bullpen. And they're going to turn it over to the guy who's been the closer over these past few seasons. Carson Spires will come on in the seventh when we come back. Tiger pitching has issued 11 walks so far today. Monty Lee turning to the team's closer, at least you would suppose that's the role Carson Spires will again have this year. One of just two seniors on the roster, the Greenville native on here with runners on first and second and no one out in the top half of inning number seven in a 4-1 game. Clemson up on the Liberty Flames, and each head coach has gone to a very valuable bullpen piece here with many outs still to be gotten. It didn't work out for Liberty and the Tigers after the sixth inning when Price came on and allowed a couple of runs. Well, it's opening day. There are many games to be played, but there is value in getting that first victory of the season in your very first contest.
Yeah, I think both managers feel that's the case. This is a very important game. You got two teams that went to the NCAA tournament last year. And so, kind of early here with Spires coming in the seventh inning last year. Spires had just a 2-5 record, but he did have 11 saves. He's got 15 saves in his career, which is in the top 10 in Clemson history. Opponents hit 220 against him. He had 44 strikeouts and 16 walks. He had 44 strikeouts and 47 and two-thirds innings.
So Carson Spires will be called on here, and you would think, even though it's the opening game, this maybe an opportunity for him to run the table. Nine outs to get. Up by three, but the leadoff man on, first and second here in the top half of inning number seven. Jalen Guy, the center fielder, good speed. Hit 257 a year ago. Reached on a walk his last time up, a fielder's choice in the fourth inning, so he's been on base a couple of times. He was caught looking his first time up in the second. Highfill, the runner at second base, as Spires turned his way. Big hole on the left side of the infield for the righty batting guy who takes strike one. See the Tigers alignment. Sam Hall shading over toward the bag. Now he moves back into position. Guy, Hall, out at second, throw to first, not in time, gets away from Ferry, so Highfill will come home with the second run of the game for Liberty. And because the ball ended up where it did, they'll allow... I'm sorry, it appeared for a second that something else was going on with the base pass, but Highfill will score. Guy will stay at first as the ball didn't go in the dugout. I thought for a second it did.
Scored an error on Ferry at first base. Second error of the game for the Tigers.
Good job by Hall to not let that one go through and to at least get the out at second base.
Yeah, Ferry's got to catch that ball.
Guy now at first. One away. And the error that allows Highfill to come around because he would have just been standing on third. So two errors in the game on the Clemson team. And Liberty's committed three errors so far. Guy getting his first run batted in of this 2020 campaign. Gray Betts, 314 hitter last year. Sophomore out of Raleigh, always son. And a dangerous man to have up there with a man at first. One and one the count on the Liberty left fielder. Was 11 of 13 in stolen base tries last season. And do not want to see him have a chance to move into scoring position.
Tiger coach is well aware of that.
And based on the error in the bottom half of the sixth inning, that enabled Hall to come home. And was a really valuable run. It also let Teodosio move all the way over to third. So on the RBI single from Henderson with two men out, Teodosio was able to score easily. So that throwing error on the catcher, Golikowski, in the Tigers' six, really essentially leading to two runs. Guy bluffing. He's going to try to steal second. Counts now one and two. But pretty important, those two runs right now in the sixth inning for Clemson. You saw Hackenberg quickly up because Guy took a couple of steps towards second base and then put on the brakes. One, two, stays inside.
Yep, a little high and inside. We almost went for it, but did not, so we have another full count.
Scoreboard shows 80 miles an hour. It looks faster than that from our perspective, but stayed outside. Carson Spires, who was as good of a high school quarterback at Greenville High as he was a pitcher. Runner goes. Left side. Parker gives chase. He'll run out of room. And, of course, if you follow Clemson baseball, you're aware of the fact, but if you hear the name Spires, and have been a fan of Clemson for many years. His dad, Mike, was a fine outfielder in the program. His uncle, Bill, an eventual major league shortstop for many years and played other positions for three major league teams during his time in the big leagues.
His dad, Michael, was the MVP of the ACC baseball tournament in 1991.
Called strike three, runner going, a delayed steal, and Guy is safe. Looked like the throw beat him, but somehow he eluded the tag of Sam Hall. That looked a little bit odd because Guy didn't look like he was running with the pitch. Big strikeout, though, for second out here in the seventh inning.
Called strikeout. Throw goes down. Wow. Good slide is what got him in there. It was close.
It looked like they had him dead to rights.
Yeah.
It was not a bad throw at all by Hackenberg.
Brings up Brandon Roars, 0-for-4 in the game.
11 strikeouts for Clemson pitching in this contest.
But also giving up 11 walks and hit two batters.
Two of those walks this inning.
I say 11, no, it's 13. No, I did put Reed. I did enter Reed, yeah. So it's got 11. It's 11 and 11.
Two away. Man now in scoring position. Roar getting ready for a strike one pitch. Little nubber left side, going to be a tough play for Hall, and he does well just to run it down and not allow Guy to come around. And they're going to score that infield hit. That'll now make the run that Highfill scored earned. Fourth hit in the game for Liberty. First for Roar.
Just the nubber off the end of the bat. Paul did a good job to get over there. Unfortunately, he didn't get by him. So we've got first and third and a two-run lead, two out. And the number three man up in the order for Liberty.
Garrett Wilkinson. Debut game for him with the Flames. Wilkinson has walked twice, and his bases loaded walk in the fourth inning delivered the first run of the season for the Flames. He struck out swinging and lined out to Hall at shortstop his last time up in inning six. Chopped on the right side, Starbuck on to first. And Spires able to clean up the damage, and as it turns out, Liberty limited to just one run. It's now a 4-2 game here in the seventh inning stretch time. Here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium, head to the bottom half of the seventh inning in the 2020 season opener. Tigers got the scoring going on a solo homer in the fourth by Sam Hall, but since then you can say they've manufactured runs. Kier Meredith stole second. He actually was scored as caught stealing, but reached there on an error. Adam Hackenberg in the fifth, the RBI single. Then in the sixth, couple of runs coming home as Clemson forced the issue. Sam Hall getting to third. Ball was thrown away by the catcher Gulikowski, and that allowed Bryce Teodosio to get all the way over to third on that play. And Elijah Henderson delivering him with a hard single to the left side. So Clemson has been able to get four runs on their six hits so far. As we head to the home seventh, they'll see a different pitcher for the Liberty Flames. After Meyer, the lefty, and Price, the righty, have come at him so far, here is a freshman making his debut for Liberty, Mason Flaherty, out of Milton, Delaware. State of Delaware represented by Rohrer, their right fielder, who's from Middletown, and Flaherty, the pitcher. That would make Paul Goldschmidt and Delino DeShields proud, among others, who played the game from the first state.
Very good. Yeah, you don't see a lot of Delaware guys out there. From a Clemson standpoint, I guess the most famous athlete we had from Delaware was Jim Bundren.
Yes.
Multiple-year All-ACC selection, who's in the Clemson Hall of Fame.
I often run into Jim at restaurants, a hefty fellow and a man who enjoyed.
But he's in good shape.
He's
He's the big guy.
Big fella. First pitch swinging, and that one's dunked into left field, and Tigers get the leadoff single out of Hackenberg here in the seventh inning. Second hit in the ball game for the Tigers sophomore catcher.
First pitch swinging. We haven't seen many guys swing at the first pitch, although I think it's the second time that Hackenberg has gotten a hit off a first pitch.
Here's a guy who swung at the first pitch of his 2020 campaign, about to stand in, Bo Makowski. Hackenberg, a little bit of a stumble over there first, but he's not necessarily known for his base run. Makowski 0-for-3 has flied out to left, and Kingsmore flied out to center and flied out to right, and in between was caught looking in the fourth. Mikowski out of Johns Creek, Georgia. Junior from the Atlanta area. Chopper charging as Locklear only plays to first, and that's one away, but moving into scoring position is Hackenberg.
Good job getting the runner. So love to get an insurance run here in the seventh. Kind of a Baltimore chop, got over the pitcher's head. Runner moves up.
Man in scoring position, the freshman lefty delivering. Stays away from Chad Ferry. 0-for-2 in the game, but has walked. Side 2-0 the count. On the Tiger first baseman hitting sixth in the order. You've got Sam Hall waiting on deck. One of the big bats in the lineup. So a good opportunity here to add an insurance run at least. He's through a 91-mile-an-hour delivery.
Ferry's dad played for Jack Leggett when Jack was the coach at Western Carolina. His dad, his uncle, Burke Ferry, played at Clemson from 1985 to 1988. And a couple of ACC championship teams.
Jack goes 3-1, and Danny Everett, home plate umpire, lets us know it was outside.
Correct. Burke had 3 home runs last year. They were all in the month of May, so he got came on strong at the end of the year.
He thought he had a walk. Instead, it's a full count. Payoff pitch. Now we'll head on down to first with a free pass. Tigers have a lot of catching up to do in that category compared to the number of walks issued by Clemson pitching, but that walk by Ferry, his second of the game, and the seventh issued by the Liberty pitching staff so far. So first and second, still just one away. Sam Hall having a big opening day in 2020. Home run in the fourth inning. Reached on a walk and came around to score on a throwing error in the sixth. A mile high on the infield. Infield fly rules, so it'll be two away. Wagner will squeeze it. Bryce Teodosio with first and second and two men out. 1-for-2 in the game, also has walked and scored.
Teodosio hit an inside the park home run at Boston College last year. You don't see a lot of inside the park home runs in college. I'm trying to remember the last time. I don't remember seeing an inside the park home run in this facility. I'm sure it's happened, but I don't remember seeing one.
Tito, so one of those guys they are hoping can make that very big step from his sophomore season to his junior season, become more productive at the plate, more consistent, I think, at the plate. He's had his moments with the bat.
Oh, yeah.
Over the first 2 years of his Clemson career.
I mean, he hit 9 home runs last year.
And he saves who knows how many runs with the work he does defensively in center field. I don't know if there's a better defensive center fielder in the ACC. Chop to third, Highfill. The few steps he needed to get the force out. The Tigers are done here in the home seventh inning. They leave two on. They'll head to the eighth with the advantage. A year ago, they were 31-1 when leading after seven. A different look behind center field at Doug Kingsmore Stadium these days, because there is now the Tiger Softball Stadium in the inaugural year. And earlier today, as they're playing host to the ACC Big Ten Challenge this weekend, the Tigers knocked off Maryland to go to 4-4 in this first week of their inaugural campaign. They've had some exciting moments already.
They have. You know, when I was the sports information director here, probably the most questions we would receive when we got phone calls, when is the football schedule coming out, and when are we going to add softball as a sport?
Such great softball tradition on the high school level in the state of South Carolina and here in the upstate of South Carolina. And as time goes on, even though the early roster really doesn't reflect it, but as time goes on, you'll see a lot of softball players from high schools not too far from this campus.
Right.
Come here and compete. And that question is no longer asked when folks call Clemson Athletics. The football schedule question still is.
Still is.
Yes.
Well, a lot of the time was because, and it's fitting that I say this on Valentine's Day, is because so many people were getting married and they want to schedule their wedding around mm-hmm. the Clemson football schedule. So that was one of the reasons we got so many.
4-2 game, top of the eighth. Liberty last season just 3-17 when trailing after seven. Hard hop, Parker, nice job, throws, and he gets a fast man running as Wagner is retired to start things out in the eighth inning. Top shelf defensive play by the Tigers sophomore third baseman. Good pick over at first
was
by Ferry as well.
The best defensive play we've seen today. It was a hard hit ball down the line, and Parker had to pick it. Had a good scoop at first over there by Ferry.
A few times in the game, the leadoff man for Liberty has been retired. Cam Locklear, the shortstop. And I'll just say that's one that got away from Carson Spires, Clemson pitcher, on for his second inning of work. Came on in relief of Sheldon Reed. Tough situation in the seventh inning.
Reed walked two batters on 3-2 pitches.
A run did score in the seventh, but a good cleanup job by Spires, the Tigers' saves leader a year ago and their presumed closer again this season.
Yeah, Spires had 11 saves last year.
Locklear can appreciate Spires' contribution to the Clemson program because Locklear is a senior as well. He's started each game since he's been at Liberty. Real team leader for them, just as Spires is for Clemson and for the Clemson pitching staff.
Spires was second in the ACC in saves last year with 11.
Count even at 2-2.
Number there. Got the call.
Locklear did strike out 38 times a season ago.
Got him.
And he goes down on strikes for a second time today. First time they've got him swinging, and that's two up and two down here in the Liberty eighth.
Got him with a high hard one. The Tigers have gotten a lot of strikeouts on. High hard ones today. That's the second strikeout for Spires and the 12th for Clemson pitching.
Strikeouts by Clemson pitching just ever so slightly outdistancing the walks. Or at least are in the same neighborhood, let's say that. Monty Lee, not sure what the conversation with Danny Everett is all about, is catcher Gulikowski gets ready to step in, the lefty batting native of Pittsburgh. Two outs, no one on for Liberty in the eighth. Tigers trying for a third win all time against the Flames, and this is the ninth meeting.
And break a four-game losing streak to the Flames.
Last played them in 2014. Year before that, played them in the NCAA tourney, and Spires ahead 0-2 on the Liberty catcher. He's gone down twice on strikes in the game.
Got him.
Called strike three, a three-pitch strikeout, and we have a first in the contest. A clean inning. Three up, three down for the Flames. Middle of the eighth. Tigers holding a 4-2 lead on opening day. Our crew dutifully continues their efforts on this opening day for 2020. He's happy he's got hair that can grow that long to stay warm out there on our center field camera. Others going with the pullover today as our fine, fine production crew here at Clemson continues.
They planned ahead and dressed appropriately.
He drew the long straw and got to be indoors with his camera today. And you notice a weather apparatus not far from that camera. As we head to the Tigers half of inning number eight here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium. And the anemometer, which, of course, what's a day at the ballpark without checking out the anemometer, is Max Starbuck, leads things off here in the eighth inning. Making his Clemson debut, and he walked in his very first plate appearance, has since popped out to high fill at third in foul territory and gone down swinging.
Hey, that's
Tudor. Freshman Fluardy on the hill for Liberty. So freshman versus freshman, Starbuck.
Of course, he redshirted last year.
Yeah, redshirted.
So he was around.
Out of Easley. Liner into left, and he's got himself the first base hit of his collegiate career. He was an on-base machine during the fall in the scrimmages for this Clemson team, and he's proved that here today, reaching for a second time.
And he hit 340 in those spring scrimmages to go with a 505 on base percentage, and he really stayed right on it and just turned on it beautifully.
Leadoff man on here in the eighth, top of the order. Elijah Henderson had an RBI single his last time up in the sixth inning and owns two of the Tigers' seven hits. Henderson from Greer played at Blue Ridge High. Redshirt sophomore getting the start in left field today.
Actually, I think it's eight hits. They haven't changed the scoreboard yet.
Oh, that is the eighth hit.
I think it's the eighth hit, yeah.
And two of them owned by Henderson.
Yeah.
Gets away. Good bounce back to the catcher Gulikowski, but Starbuck easily able to get down to second base.
This is a career high two hits for Henderson. Did, as we said, he had just five hits all last year, so nice to see him get off to a good start. He did hit a home run last year. at Louisville. Or against Louisville.
Now a chance for another RBI in the game. Yeah, it looks like strike two. Henderson in left today primarily, well, for a couple of reasons. Had freshman catcher Jonathan French not come up with a knee injury, he probably would have been the DH today, but French, Monty Lee announced, has gone down to a leg injury. Don't want to be specific on that. In fact, I'm not sure it's even a knee injury, but they're going to evaluate French in about a month. And able to lay off is Henderson. So French would be a DH. If Davis Sharp weren't pitching tomorrow, perhaps he'd be the DH today. And Meredith, who'd been under the weather this week, that's why they used him as a designated hitter, could have played left field today if he'd had to. But that gave Henderson the opportunity in the lineup in left field.
And Meredith's on deck.
And Henderson certainly making the most of that opportunity. Thought about it and instead takes a call, third strike for out number one.
Yeah, probably caught the corner. Nice pitch. So here comes Meredith. I said in the pregame just about every time I saw him play last year, and he only played 9 games, he had a significant impact on the game. Today's got a hit by a pitch, walked, scored a run.
And Meredith, a bunt that stays in the air for a while, and that's what speed can do for you. Another infield hit for the Tigers, this time for Kier Meredith. His second hit of the contest.
At the top of the order now with 4 hits.
Puts him on first and third and still just one away. Boy, that stayed up in the air for a while.
Yeah, it was perfect. Perfect bunt. That triangle of no return for the defense.
And, of course, with Starbuck on second, there was no way they had any chance to get him over at third.
So now it's first and third. You got to wonder if they try to send Meredith. Tigers feel pretty comfortable, but it's still only a 2-run game.
Yeah. Time granted, and we'll see Scott Jackson, who has the unique position as a head coach and also been a pitching coach, so his trips to the mound can be pretty valuable. Matt Williams is the Liberty pitching coach. We've seen him make a visit. You've got a freshman on the mound making his debut for Liberty. It's going to be a situation where I would suppose they'll bring the infield in, but Jackson looks like he's talking more with his infielder and his catcher about scenarios, especially if the Tigers try to have Parker safety squeeze here. Activity in the bullpen for the Flames, and they've got a righty up, Troy Britz, a sophomore.
They are going to make a change.
So they perhaps needed just to give Britz a little bit more of an opportunity. And as Danny Everett, the home plate umpire, visited the mound, the pitching change is made. We'll see another hurler for Liberty when we come back. Another freshman out of the pen for the Liberty Flames, Troy Britz out of Orange Park, Florida, just outside of Jacksonville, and kind of a herky-jerky delivery for the 6 foot 180 pounder, but he'll be called on to try to work out of a jam in a 4-2 game. Clemson on top here in the home eighth. Tigers on first and third and good speed. Max Starbuck at third, and Kier Meredith, who actually reached second but was still part of a caught stealing play in which the shortstop Locklear dropped the throw, and that proved to be big when Meredith reached second in inning number five. He eventually came around with the go-ahead run, and the Tigers have led since. But trying to add on here in the late innings of opening day 2020.
Britzwood, he was a senior as a graduate program. He was 5-2 with a 2.03 ERA at 75 strikeouts in 51 2/3 innings as a senior.
St. John's Country Day.
Also ran cross country and was on the swimming team in high school. You don't see a lot of baseball swimming combinations.
You rarely see swimmers excel in other sports. They're usually great in that. Mercer has a basketball player who's one of the best rebounders in the Southern Conference and still holds the 50-meter freestyle record at his
wow,
high school.
Wow, how about that?
So, but that quite unique
yeah.
in each case. Folks still hanging in there. Earlier in the day, some were in their short sleeves, maybe just a light sweater, but the jackets have come on as it's a 40-degree night, mid-40s night right now here at Doug Kingsmore Stadium. So a big opportunity for James Parker, the Clemson third baseman, who made a really nice defensive play in the top half of this eighth inning.
We talked about squeeze situations. You got to wonder if...
Hard smash right up the middle into center field. Starbucks scoring easily. Meredith on his way to third, and James Parker delivering with his first hit of the year. RBI number one, and the Tigers build the lead back out to three runs.
Well, that hit's got to make Monty Lee breathe a little bit easier. A big difference between a two-run lead and a three-run lead when we go to the top of the ninth inning. But, boy, Parker really stayed right on that ball and hit it where it was pitched, which is always good to see.
Adam Hackenberg has singled his past two times up. Five runs now on 10 hits for Clemson. And he offered, I don't know if that was a safety squeeze situation because the pitch was well outside.
Yep. If you're going to squeeze, you would think Meredith would be a guy you would do it with. Although you do have your number four guy in the order up who's got two hits.
And Hackenberg grounding to third. High fill to second for one. Catcher running over to first. And for a second time in the game, Liberty turns the double play. Score at 5-4-3. And just one run coming home in the inning for Clemson, although Monty Lee out of the dugout. And I do believe he wants them to take a look at the play at first base. He held his hands up on either side of his head for the indication, so we may have a review of what for now stands as an inning-ending double play for Liberty. Danny Everett, the home plate umpire, and out there to talk things over with two of the members of his crew, actually all three of the others now joining him. They're having a discussion. Monty Lee gave the indication that he wanted that play at first to be reviewed. Keep it here
I always,
for the moment.
Got a little bit of a kick out of it. Baseball, they always have this filibuster.
So the play will be under review?
And then they always go and review it. I mean, yes. Why not just go and review it? Why do you have to meet? But in college baseball, it seems they always have this meeting, and then they always decide to go review it. So
we will be providing them with that replay and taking a look as they do. Wagner made a good turn at second base with the runner Parker bearing down on him. If it doesn't stand as a double play, the Tigers will have a sixth run in this game because, of course, Meredith was able to come across
yeah.
the plate.
When I saw it live, I thought he was out.
Looked like they got him by just a half step.
Yeah.
And you see Meredith on the split box. So the throw to first, and it's going to be the key. We're going to see the end of that in just a moment. End of the play in just a moment. And here we go. And let's see if the throw beats him, and it does. So it's going to be a 5-4-3 double play. We will await the official word. This ball looks like it hits the back of the glove right there before the foot.
It was closer than
very
I thought,
close.
Though. Yeah.
Give Hackenberg credit for the hustle and the stretch at the very last second, but it looks like it just gets them before the foot comes down on the bag. And, of course, they need enough video evidence to overturn what has been called an out at first, so that's something else that is going against the Tigers.
It's certainly worth challenging for Monty.
No, absolutely.
You could add another run.
Absolutely, with a run potentially to go up on the board. but it looks like the call was accurate by the first place umpire, first base umpire, Craig Barron. And we await the umpire's reemergence from the room behind the Clemson dugout. Danny Everett, our home plate umpire and crew chief, will say that the out stands. And so a 5-4-3 double player to end the Tigers' eight. But they head to the ninth with a 5-2 advantage. Season number 5 for Monty Lee at the helm of Clemson begins. Maybe he knew he was going to be on camera as he was standing with his coaching brain trust, Andrew C. and Brad LaCroix, and the fellow wearing the ski cap. Tiger fans recognize him, one of the great sluggers in Clemson history, Ben Paulson, on for his second year as the director of player development. Ninth inning in the 2020 season opener. And Carson Spires on in his third inning, trying to open this campaign with a save. It would enable Jeffrey Gilbert to get a victory in his Clemson debut. Gilbert pitched a couple of innings. Came on in relief of the starter Sam Weatherly in the fifth. Spires, 11 saves a year ago, starts things out against Highfill, the third baseman for the Liberty Flames, who's ahead in the count, 2-0. Ball three. Highfill has reached twice via the walk and also has a double in the contest. A little bit too much movement for Spires' liking on that pitch. Taking all the way. Seven, eight, nine in the order for the Flames here in the ninth. And the count goes full.
Spires has had pretty good control overall. Come back from 3-0 and get a strikeout. Got 29 pitches, 20 strikes.
Swing and a miss. Wow, what a comeback from 3-0 to record yet another strikeout since he came on. That's the fourth for Spires so far in the game.
Three straight. Yeah, he's getting a lot of action. Looks like he's going to pitch three. Got a pinch hitter coming in.
Pinch hitter for the Liberty Flames. Bachman. First baseman for this team. Hit 200 a year ago with 10 batted in. And served as a designated hitter primarily in the 2019 campaign. Sophomore out of Carlisle, Pennsylvania. 6'3", 200. We noted earlier in the telecast, Logan Matthew, they thought returned as their first baseman, led their conference in RBIs with 52 a year ago, but out for the season with a knee injury. Stays up there forever before it is squeezed for out number two by the Tigers' second baseman, Max Starbuck. So Clemson one out away from opening up 2020 with a victory. And a game that, again, a series in general against a very good Liberty team that they are taking nothing for granted.
Well, yeah, I mean, Liberty has a 6-2 all-time record against Clemson, as we said before. That's the best winning percentage of any team against the Tigers, giving them a minimum of six games.
Jalen Guy driving home a run his last time up. As he reached on a fielder's choice. Grounded to Hall at short. This should do it. Bobbled, fast man running, and Liberty still has life. I spoke too soon.
Yep, it was a standard grounder.
Second error in the game on the Tigers' shortstop. Three overall. Guy at first, top of the order, and Gray Betts. Fifth plate appearance in the ball game. Hall inheriting the position from one of the great shortstops in Clemson history, Logan Davidson. What a career he had. And he graduated in essentially 2.5 years. That's the other thing. And
Yeah, amazing academic
well-rounded
career.
Student athlete. Hard shot to first, and that one right through Ferry. Making the turn, Betts, he'll head to second. They will wave Guy all the way around. It's a 5-3 ball game. And a man on second now with two men out, Betts.
That ball was hit hard, but boy, you got to block it. You got to get down and block it. Been a tough day defensively for Ferry at first base. And the ball was hit hard. But you got to at least smother it.
Brings up a good hitter, Rohrer. Didn't homer last season, but he hit 311. Two-run game, two men out. And in scoring position for Liberty.
Got to hit his last time up, 1-for-4 on the game.
Second error in the inning, 4 in the game for Clemson. Rohrer has struck out twice, once swinging, once looking. Grounded to Ferry at first and also flied out, but he does have a hit in the game.
Strike two.
One of just four for Liberty. But Spires ahead in the count, 0-2. Trying to close it out right here.
Ooh, a little low, little low.
Too close to call here in the ninth inning. One-two pitch. And we'll do it again. Good number of the faithful have hung around for a ball game that's coming up on 3.5 hours in length. That guy, though, sure happy he stayed. Got himself a souvenir.
Kind of a baseball. You know, back in the 80s, managers would go and retrieve the baseballs.
Yes.
Because those were the
they were budgets. A commodity back
the
then.
The way budgets were in those
yes.
days.
One of the ways time has changed at the old ballpark. Rolled on the right side. Starbuck to first, and that'll do it. And the Clemson Tigers start out the 2020 campaign with a 5-3 victory over the Liberty Flames. Congratulations, Jeffrey Gilbert, the freshman out of Bishop England in Charleston in his very first Clemson contest. He gets his first career win. Carson Spires, a save in his first appearance for the 2020 campaign. And the tough luck loss by Mason Meyer, the starter, who was very solid in his 5 innings of work for Liberty, allowing just a couple of runs, but a good start for a Clemson team, which has many, many questions to answer over the first few weeks of this campaign.
Always good to win the opener, and you won the opener against the team that went to the NCAA tournament last year and is supposed to go back this year, so good win for the Tigers.
Same two teams tomorrow at 1 p.m. We'll have it for you on the ACC Digital Network. Davis Sharp will make his season debut on the hill for Clemson against a good righty, Noah Sciro, for the Liberty Flames. Tigers got a little bit of thump off the bat of Sam Hall. Some timely hitting and solid pitching when all was said and done. The 2020 season opener is in the books. A 5-3 win for Clemson. On behalf of Tim Bure and our fine crew, Pete Yannity saying so long. This has been a presentation of ESPN.